And hello, everybody, and welcome to the Monastery, the world's greatest shit show, the open bar of the internet, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this holy of temples, seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, and most batshit ways possible. It is November the 10th. Remember the 10th of November. Yeah, that doesn't work out the second time around. I am, as always, your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra. And with me, I have my good brother of the night, the biggest head in Chicago, the bane of NPCs, and the man who could probably be a better QB than Mitch kissing titties, good brother Aaron. How you doing tonight?
We're Oregons! I swear to God, I'm really getting tired of this shit from these fucking Puritans.
The only time I should ever have to ask the question, where are her organs, is if I'm dealing with Izumi Curtis from Full Metal Alchemist.
Oh my God.
And in that case, that was a more messed up story.
Yeah, but these motherfuckers, I swear to God, I'm going to start slapping them. But there is some good news of this. I chose wisely in who I want to handle my character design.
Yep. And Kyoryu, I see in the chat, and he's saying that he might end up getting addicted to American cider. But, and Airball, yes, we do have an alarm for the full quartet. I want to point out that if any of you did not see the interview that I did with Broken Dice Studios, developers of the Nuanden Chronicles, fix that when you get the chance, because that may be my best interview I've done so far. Grant, I've only done less than a baker's dozen of them, so take that with a grain of salt. It was a nice change of pace to cover Numenera, and also I have the reviews all locked in for the next 3 weeks. So basically the remainder of November. I'm going to start scripting on the December reviews possibly in about 3 days. That being said...
One thing. About that full quartet alarm. Is it the same thing like the Jets butt fumble alarm?
No. I feel like it needs a siren.
Oh, damn. I think we got tech problems again.
What?
God damn it. Hold on a second. You know, you're in Discord.
Oh, God damn it.
Swear to God. God damn my fucking ISP. Hold on. Let me... Okay, you back, man?
Testing. Are we back?
Okay. Okay, I can definitely hear you now.
Fuck it. We'll do it live.
Son of a bitch. It's been doing this all night.
Mm-hmm. A shameful display!
Oh my God. Well, at least you're still green on Discord.
Oh, thank God for small favors. I might end up changing up some of the imagery for the show in the future. But let's get started with a bit of grifting.
Yep.
So
time to grift.
The current so Once again, now I am very glad that the Impact shows that took place over this weekend, the ticket sales for that are going to go to the campaign. So this is probably going to have a bit of a jump in the near future. Mm. It's just that it's probably going to take a few days before we actually see it. We might not see the full progress until next week. But they're up by I'd say about 2,000 since the last time we saw it. And
can't hear you on Discord again. I think it's from my end. Let me get in and get out.
All right. 16,429 is what it's currently at. Unfortunately, I have no way to check to see what it was beforehand. But the closer it gets to 50,000, the better. I don't think it's a headset issue, Homer. But we will... No, damn.
Yeah, it's just being Discord being a dick.
Well, we're not off to the best of starts with the Kickstarter Spotlight.
Yep. Time to play. All right, let's see here. Okay. Where are you? Okay, hit it, Sven!
Midnight and my show's a nightlight and I'm canceled. The movies are cheap and put viewers to sleep, so I'm canceled.
What a damn shame. Because it looked good.
Dark Void, which is trying to go for the aesthetic and feel of 80s SF and cyberpunk. It's coming to us from Hamburg, Germany. They're hamburgers.
Mm-hmm.
And... Well, As far as the preview kit, I might take a deeper look at that.
Yeah, let's see here. Oh boy. I don't know why I think they saw something wrong and decided to go back to the drawing board. See, folks, again, pregame your shit.
All right. I'm opening up the preview kit in a short story. In a different thing. Let's see. Their artwork is certainly on point.
Oh, definitely.
Especially the space kraken right here.
Oh boy. Now if they're going for 80s cyberpunk and science fiction, I'll be honest with you. The whole space cricket thing and a couple other things, that looks a little bit... Ooh. That looks a little too out there.
How much pulp SF have you read?
Not much.
Just saying. But... Now, apparently this was his first... One that he created. Let me see if he put anything in the updates. He said. And he put up a thing saying, "Hello everyone. The campaign has been live for 1 week and we are at 5%. I've received some great feedback from some of you and others regarding my plan, and I've come to the conclusion to end the campaign for now. I've learned so much in this first run, and I'm thankful for every supporter. However, this is just a minor setback. I'll use all my newfound knowledge to come back with a new campaign in the near future. You can expect it in the first quarter of 2020. In the meantime, if you want your daily dose of Dark Void, be sure to check my socials. Links are in the campaign text. By the way, I'll post a preview of the next campaign as an update to this campaign, so you can be the first ones to check it out and give me feedback. Till then, Moritz.
And so basically, they jumped the gun.
And I'm just gonna put this out there, Moritz. When you get the next Kickstarter off the ground next year, or whenever you end up doing it, the door is always open to my temple if you want to come in and talk about what you've got in store.
Definitely. Like I said, I think you're gonna need to start making the rounds and the interviews before you launch it again. Because like I said, I think that's the problem with most games. They don't understand the power of actually.
God, I think Aaron, you dead? Did the McCaskies get you? Well then, and Misanthropic, I've been doing pretty good.
I'm gonna fucking kill those assholes at Discord, I swear to God.
Misanthropic saying I'm one away from 420 subs. I have to smoke grass on camera to celebrate. No,
oh boy.
I'm not doing that. I'm not a smoker anyways.
Yeah.
I might review something that was probably made on weed, like say Gamma World or something. But next we have Quest, a vastly versatile tabletop RPG that's incredibly fair and balanced, calling itself the Boundless Yet Balanced RPG, coming to us from Cedar City, Utah. This is his. He's created four Kickstarters. Let's see. A lot of what I'm seeing, I can certainly. Once again, art style is on point, but I'm looking for. I see a lot of setting material and saying that he has well over 100 classes, which That's a
100 classes, buddy. This is not Ogre Battle.
Okay then. That's a bold fucking strategy. Let's see if it pays off.
Good God, it may work for Ogre Battle, but it won't work for this. And Ogre Battle's a damn good game.
Okay, so he goes into a bit of character creation a little bit down the line. We're starting stats, okay. Pick race, choose four feats, then roll your birth sign, roll for HP and MP. Get a fucking editor!
Oy vey. He's being way too ambitious with this one. Unless he's got a game plan. I don't know.
The big problem that I like the concept of his little zodiac here, but here's the big problem that I'm having with this. He is not telling me how this thing is working that is going to be unique. Now I know that might sound a bit harsh, but let's see who we've got here. All right, he's coming to us from Cedar City, Sete Ludgren. What this really needs is some kind of is some kind of quick start. Because yeah, he's put a lot of this stuff out there, but I think he's put a little bit too much in the wrong way. And that's not to say I want this to fail. I want this to succeed. I want every Kickstarter we spotlight to succeed.
But this is a bit. This is like ambitious as hell, in my opinion. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm not totally against ambition, but there's shit that you can accomplish, and then there's you're gonna need probably a lot of heads to put all this shit together.
Well, there's also the fact that he wants to talk about the game being balanced.
Let's see here. Let's go to that highest pledge. Look, here it is. 62 races, 120 birth sides, 400 feats and abilities, 18 more races, 100 extra feats, 150 classes. Jesus H. Christ! Damn! I know mods that don't go that high. I'm talking about fucking Skyrim mods. Hold on. Gotta disconnect, reconnect again. Fucking Discord. I see what I'm gonna be doing all night.
Yep, but we will do it live.
God damn, what is going on fucking Discord tonight? Because it's like all of a sudden you go silent. I don't know what's going on my end. I don't know what's going on your end. Ugh.
And here are you, I think, with the winning comment. Okay, there's jumping the shark, but now you've jumped the shark tank, got the t-shirt, then decided to immediately jump 20 tanks.
Exactly.
I'm not going to go that far, but the vibe that I'm getting out of this is somebody who is counting their chickens before they hatch.
Yeah. And by the way, Homer, this game didn't specifically say it was inspired by Ogre Battle. I basically said with all those fucking classes, it sounded like fucking Ogre Battle.
Except Ogre Battle has squads in skirmish.
Yeah.
Although I'm assuming that when you say Ogre Battle, you're referring to Let Us Cling Together.
No, that's Tactics Ogre. And I've been playing that.
The same series.
Yeah, I know. I've been playing that. I've been playing that a lot recently. Now, when I talk about a lot of freaking classes, I'm talking about March of the Black Queen.
Fair enough. Let's see. So the next one that we have is The Curse of the House of Rookwood, which this one has actually managed to exceed its goal, and it's got quite some time to go.
Let's see here.
As they're asking for 5,000, they're currently at 5,300. They got 28 days left. And not bad. What's apparently their first Kickstarter.
Not bad.
Because The Curse of the House of Rockwood is a gothic horror RPG where you create a cursed family with supernatural powers and troubled relationships. And then take them on strange adventures in alternate history haunted by mythical monsters and dark magic. Will you bury your skeletons, or will family drama bring your house to ruin?
What am I... You know, I'm getting some How to Host a Murder vibes with this one.
That's not the vibe I'm getting out of this. Did you ever watch The Fall of the House of Usher?
Heard about it. You basically
for this setup... Your ancestor formed a pact with things that they shouldn't, at the cost and granting power to his bloodline at the cost of their humanity. The more gifts of the curse, the more inhuman you become.
Wait a minute. I think I know what you're talking about, because that's sort of the same storyline they went with in one of the quests from Fallout 4. It was based on House of Usher, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Ah, okay, I see. I get the point though, because in Fallout 4 there's a sort of a quest line where you have to where it sort of follows that storyline. But I see where they're getting at.
And thank you very much for sharing the stream, Dr. No.
Yeah, thank you, man.
The more eyes on us, the better. So let's see. So the other thing is that, of course, you're haunted by skeletons, unresolved matters that strain relationships and could tear the family apart. You'll either put them to rest, ensuring the future prosperity of the family, or bury them in a shallow grave, hastening the family's demise.
Oh, skeletons.
Chronicler...
Are we talking literal or figurative?
I think figurative. Possibly both, depending on how the game wants to be run. During play, a chronicler, I'm assuming that's their name for the DM, serves as facilitator, historian, and GM. So, it is. Portraying the dark world in which the family must survive. So you can either do this as a single generation story or as a legacy style campaign that spans multiple generations in the family. I like that idea. I've always been a sucker for multi-generation stories. And yes, that was what roped me into JoJo. So they mention it's a supernatural adventure. A family drama, and a gothic alternate history. And I do like that they didn't stick to just one time period. We can go with the gothic 1880s, the pulpy 1920s, a ghost blitz in the 1940s, or clairvoyant Russian spies in the spy-fi 1960s.
Yes. Folks, if I go in and out throughout the entire stream, that's me trying to jump in and jump out and back in because I can't hear Mildred on the Discord, so I'm getting tech problems of my own.
All right. I am looking at the... Now, fortunately, when I saw this sort of storyline set up, I immediately suspected that we were going to deal with Powered by the Apocalypse. Nope. Mm-hmm. It's using its own system.
Pretty good.
And the playtest rules are on itch.io. Mm-hmm. So every family member has 3 traits: brawn, guile, and weird. You assign 5 6-sided dice among the traits. Each trait has a different colored die. I hope I'm not going to have to do multiple colored dies like I had to do with Mythender. Mm-hmm. Your character does something where the outcome is unclear. You set the stakes for the scene with the chronicler, risks, and rewards. Then you roll dice based on the amount of effort you want to put in. More effort means more dice, but at a chance of a greater cost. So apparently the approach that they take is that you can either do normal effort where you roll 1d6 and if you get a 4, you get a success. Extraordinary effort where you roll 2d6 and each four higher counts as a success, but you lose a die if you roll doubles. Or supernatural effort where you roll 3 die, each four or higher gets a success, but if you roll doubles, you lose 1 die and gain a mark.
Oof.
Let's see. If it also goes that if the trait of the die you roll matches what you're doing thematically, you gain 2 successes from any die that roll a 6.
That sounds good.
If you use the power granted by your curse, that's the only time you can use supernatural effort. If any die come up doubles in that case, you gain a mark on your curse and lose a bit more of humanity. I do like this kind of thing. It's a case of how lucky do you feel? Your curse grants a gift along with some potential ways to use it, as well as marks. One sample of curse they give here is the curse of the rookery. That someday blackbirds will feast on your entrails, but until then you have power over them. Crows and ravens gather everywhere you go, watching with glittering black eyes, cackling over the secrets of the dead. They are allies and supplicants, gifting you with the rumors and trinkets they collect. They're always watching and screaming their animal screams. It doesn't matter how you hide. So, let's see, you can command crows to attack, ask nearby crows for favors or information. Remember to be polite. You can command your crows to defend you. A murder of crows is always close at hand. Dispatch them across a wide area as your own personal spy network.
Here we go. Here we go. Fucking Bioshock Infinite. It flashbacks.
Let's see. Marks of the rookery. Feathers for hair. Crow's feet. Shining black eyes. Croaking voice. Avian demeanor. Kleptomania. Talon-like hands of feet. Eyes pecked out.
Huh.
Let's see, these skeletons that haunt your relationships give you ample fodder for role-playing and also give you a way to restore lost dice. Each skeleton has a spine and bones. The spine is the family member that is the focus, and bones are possible scenes or events that bring your skeleton into the foreground of the story, allowing you and another player to restore a lost die or pool when they occur. And we have a sample one, a skeleton need for approval. You are desperate for approval from blank, and I'm assuming that in an actual game you would write one of the other player characters at the table for this.
Yeah.
So bones. Every time you do the spine's bidding without reward, you both restore one spent trait. If you sacrifice something to do it, restore two traits. Blank is always getting recognized instead of you. When they are praised for something you are good at, you both restore one spent trait. You bury when you get the recognition you deserve from your spine. You both gain a new trait plus one legacy point. Or if you refuse to help the person from your spine, you gain a new trait and lose one legacy point. See, then they go into the rewards. They chose an appropriate art style, where I can't tell if they've repurposed classical art or if they added their own stuff.
Yeah.
And it looks like they've got a few other things that they are planning. They are partnering with Fulfillright for shipping and delivery of physical rewards. Good luck with that in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. Then we have some of the people who are involved with this. Michael Adson, who is passionate about horror movies and all things gothic, and will gladly talk about his collection of weird black clothing if you ask nicely. His first published game, Space Princess, funded successfully in 2018. Rookwood is his first RPG design, but probably not his last. You've been warned. Let's see. Ugh. Apparently Brian Bind, who's one of the people involved with this, was one of the six Iron Gods behind the original development of Iron Kingdoms when it was a D&D 3rd edition setting. And has done stuff for Warrior, Rogue, and Mage. Ooh, I like that.
Yeah.
And I love this in here. He now lives in Hawaii, and the curse of the House of Rookwood may be his attempt to compensate for the never-ending nightmare of sun, sand, and surf in which he finds himself.
it's definitely on my end. I'm taking a look at my connection thing. It seems like I'm getting lag spikes.
That's weird.
Yeah, it's called Comcast S router being stupid. Shit, if this keeps doing it more, I might have to do this whole thing through my phone. God damn.
But as far as the House of Rookwood, this one I could see working. Like, if it was using Powered by the Apocalypse, I'd be a little more suspicious, but since it's not, I see something in this.
Oh, def, same here. This could be a I know it annoys you when I say how to host a murder, but you know what? It's like how to host a murder, but you actually, there's actually fucking gameplay.
And for what it's worth, this is probably going to be obvious, but I do not consider How to Host a Murder a tabletop RPG. It's a LARP.
Exactly.
It's as much of a LARP as Tony and Tina's Wedding or Triple Espresso.
Tony and Tina's Wedding? Really? We're going that? We're going there?
Yes.
Oh, God.
Yeah, we're going there.
Tony and Tina's Wedding and How to Host a Murder. Hey, that could actually be a good crossover. Oh, boy.
So, next. Now, a while back, we had talked about Traveler coming back with Traveler 5th Edition. Well, now they're doing it. Now they are kickstarting a campaign thing. I do love that they were only asking for 25,500, and they're at 82,000 and change with 20 days to go. Then again, you have two things in. They have two things in their favor. One, Mongoose, one of the heavy hitters in the independent scene.
Yeah.
Two, it's fucking Traveler. Traveler has been the gold standard when it comes to space opera tabletop games for decades.
Yep.
But yeah, Deep Night Revelation, which they plan on being the most expansive campaign ever produced for Traveler. And I will admit, when I first found out about it, I thought it said the most expensive. Let's see, a converted heavy cruiser, Deep Night Revelation is one of the most powerful exploration vessels ever commissioned. Equipped for a 20-year voyage, she will carry the travelers on an epic journey from charted space to the edge of the Orion Arm. Deep Night Revelation must forge a path through uncharted systems and the territory of unknown alien races. Everything she finds will be new, and if she meets with disaster, there will be no rescue. No pressure!
Oh boy, sounds like it's Kobayashi Maru the game.
Apparently its destination is a radio source at the mouth of the Great Rift. Described in the ravings of a madwoman as a place beyond everything, Terminus Point holds a terrible secret. Reaching it is only part of the mission. At Terminus Point, the travelers will face a desperate battle to prevent mass extinction on the galactic scale and literally go further than any traveler has gone before.
Oh my God. Well, look at this one. At least they're gonna do this a lot better than Star Trek Discovery.
Yeah, but that's not exactly saying much. But seriously, really? Look, I know Traveler's been an institution for around 30 years, give or take. But could you not make the obvious joke? Seriously? I mean,
of course they couldn't.
I was tempted to make the joke and I held back. I deserve credit for that.
Well, they beat you to it. Don't get salty.
I am not salty. Homer is saying, for a second I laughed like the Yenzer.
yeah. There.
So, the box, it'll be a box set that contains four books, a card deck, and a poster map. Stretch goals unlocking additional hardbacks to expand the campaign, covering new adventures and regions of space. This is an old school. This seems to be an old school sandbox style campaign box.
Oh,
let's see. So we have Deep Night Legacy, a adventure that introduces the travelers to the task. Campaign Guide, which puts out the scope of the campaign. A Referee's Handbook, which guides them through it. The Terminus Point, a adventure into the more distant and fantastical realms that forms the great finale of the campaign. A big-ass poster map containing deck plans of the Deep Night Endeavor along with crew departments. While the reverse has a huge-scale map depicting the expected route of the journey along the Great Rift and known points of interest. A deck of cards covering mission briefings, standing orders, and mission roles. I know you might be tilting your eyebrow over the deck of cards, but this is basically like the index cards that I would have boxes of back in the day. Let's see. Most of the writing for the box set is complete, and you can grab the first adventure for free. Although it's a playable work in progress, but it is a work in progress. It goes into that, and goes into the feels. And apparently they want it to be more than just an episodic 5-year mission style of game, and have drawn a lot and drew. They drew on a lot of sources of inspiration. Apparently, they recommend referees immerse themselves in the likes of the Cosmos TV series, both the new one and the original, as well as Sunshine and Interstellar, on a big 4K screen with full surround sound. Let's see, we have a few of the pledge levels, and a few stretch goals. The highest one is 250 pounds, so about 100. And now the highest stretch goal is only 120 pounds, or about $154. But I'd say this is well in hand, and I'm going to make a bit of a declaration. If there is enough demand for it, after Zeitgeist is done, I will cover the Deep Night Revelation campaign.
Okay.
I cannot say when I will do it, because let's be honest, this thing at the amount of bank this thing has made, and it's only got 20 days left, this thing is meeting its goal. It's fucking shattering it.
It shattered its goal. Shit, I wouldn't be surprised if it gets up to like, I would say, 200,000.
Mm-hmm. And I do have the new edition of Traveler. I have considered reviewing it, but I will freely admit reviewing Traveler is going to be intimidating. Because again, you're talking about one of those big time institutions for the hobby. Much like how reviewing a BattleTech game was intimidating for me. It's not that I can't do it. It's going to be a challenge to do it and give it its proper due.
Oh yeah. Anyway, hold on a second. I'm going to restart Discord, okay?
All right. I'm going to soldier on. So, the next one that we have is Alwa's Legacy, which is about halfway done with what it needs. It's coming to us from Gothenburg, Sweden. Although I think the amount of SKUs that they want to put this on, it might be a bit ambitious. They want to put this on the Switch, the PS4, the Xbox, Steam, and GOG. Thank the gods I do not see any Epic Game Store in there.
Ugh, thank God. Okay. Hopefully I don't get the same crap I've been getting all night. But anyway.
So
yeah, no Epic Game Store garbage here.
So it looks like they want to do a non-linear adventure with a bit of a retro spin where your main claim to fame is how creatively you can utilize your magic, especially with this whole block thing that we see here.
Sounds like a mix between La Mulana and Bubble Bobble.
And So I get the feeling you're gonna have jump and then three spell buttons. And I think this is a game that wants to reward you for figuring out creative ways to use your spells.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like something I probably would pick up.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Exploration is rewarded.
A talking pig NPC. Oh, boy. You're trying to rip off Wonder Boy the Dragon's Trap, aren't ya?
Have you ever read Journey to the West?
No, I haven't.
We had to deal with a pig in that one. Why do you think Oolong is a pig in Dragon Ball?
Well, look at it this way. Well, at least it ain't a smoking pig.
No.
Then that would be ripoff.
No, I had pork chops earlier. And it does look like it's getting a fair bit of press. Although the guy on the right in the bottom picture looks a little bit too much like Cinema Snob for my liking.
Hold on a second. Yes, he does. He looks a little like Brad Jones. Mm-hmm. That's a bad thing. Brad Jones is all right.
As far as their environmental design with the sprite work, it's definitely on point.
Oh, definitely. Definitely.
And it looks like they also have some decent concept and sound designers. They are aiming for Steam, Nintendo Switch, Xbox One, and PS4. As well as Steam and GOG. Once again, I'm glad that I don't see a Epic Game Store in there, which, considering Steam's policy changes, I don't think they'll be able to do that at the last minute without getting themselves in trouble.
Nope.
Apparently, it's almost completely done, but they need one last push with Kickstarter.
I see. So this is sort of their, So this is basically their all-in.
It's their all-in, and I will admit I hope they can manage it, because I see something special out of this, and I could easily see recommending this to Shades or even to myself.
Yeah, definitely.
See, there is a demo available, but it's for backers only. Let's see what the minimum amount to do the demo is. I think it should be done by just 200 kronens or $21, which. The last one we have is from our old friends at Free League Publishing. And unsurprisingly, they have fucking destroyed their goal with only 16 days. Of course. So they were asking for 10,300 or 100,000 kronens. They are currently at 146,400 with 16 days left.
Yeah, they got over 1.5 million kronens.
And funded in 13 minutes, damn.
Ooh!
I think part of the reason they were able to do it, and this is a case of... Free League is one of the heavy hitters in the tabletop scene in Eastern Europe. And these are the same people that have handled Tales from the Loop, Forbidden Lands, the upcoming Alien game... They also have Mutant Year Zero under their belt. And yeah, this is their 21st Kickstarter. So Vaisen, Nordic Horror Role Playing, which is being written by Niels Hintze, who's behind Tales from the Loop, and based on the work of illustrator and author Johan Ergekens. Sorry if I mispronounced your name. It is going with a gothic setting steeped in Nordic folklore in the old myths of Scandinavia. Okay, you have my attention. And it is using the Year Zero engine. Okay, you definitely have my attention. So they are looking to get about 200 pages worth of content in a core rule book that'll have rules, setting, and an introductory scenario. Pretty standard fare. And using the US letter format. Let's see, they apparently also want to try and do a limited edition version of the book with the cloth setup. Kind of reminds me of the version of the limited edition book for Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay 4th. Let's see, what do you do? You and your companions in the society were born different. You have the sight, the ability to see what ordinary people can't. You know that Vaesen have lived beside humanity for untold centuries in an uneasy peace. Not anymore. Rumors spread of kittens born with two heads, streams red from blood, groves lulling children into eternal sleep, fairies dancing through villages, luring the young into the woods to be forever enthralled. Embarking on the journeys to remote villages in the wilderness, you will uncover the secrets of Mythic North. Armed with nothing but courage, conviction, and the ability to see supernatural, you'll face the creatures of the forest. Neither bullets nor blades can stop them. To drive them off, you must understand them, find their weakness. Even if you prevail, facing the Vaesen will leave you with scars that never heal. So, no pressure. No pressure at all. Let's see. Aaron, are you back yet? Nope, he's not. Let's see. So we're dealing with the Mythic North, loosely based in Scandinavia in the 19th century.
All right.
And welcome back.
Yeah, again.
I do like the map that we have here.
All right, let's see here. Oh. So basically, it's an alt. Is it supposed to be the supposed to be Scandinavia or a fictionalized version of it?
The latter.
Ah.
And hang on, Exia is saying, "What about them Vikings?" Let me check on that.
Let's see.
Oh, they're beating them boys, even if it's only by 3.
Beat them boys!
Don't do the whole full thing.
I'm not doing the whole thing. Yep.
Let's see, and they've unlocked the GM screen, which I have to say that's probably the most appropriate art for a GM screen that I've seen so far.
Mm.
Now, having the Lady of the Lake who is completely done with your shit.
Oh, speaking of football, it looks like Cam Newton wants to play for the Bears.
Don't take him.
Yeah, I wouldn't.
Apparently they're also, for whatever reason, they're also advertising some of their other stuff. So, and yeah, I forgot to mention Things from the Flood, which is basically a standalone sequel to Tales from the Loop.
Well, I can see why they're on their 21st Kickstarter.
Forbidden Lands, I did back and I did own, and it's pretty damn good. It's basically in the same system as the other games, just doing a more fantasy approach. And Mutant Year Zero, exactly what you think it is. I do like that it got to jump into a video game form. Coriolis, also very good. Simbaurum, very good. It's like Free League for a company that's only been around since 2011, they've put out some astonishing stuff in the last few years. And I'd say Vasen is going to be one more notch on their belts.
Oh, definitely.
Because I'm always a sucker for gothic horror. And the idea of doing that with a bit more of a Scandinavian approach, when, let's be honest, most of the time when gothic horror is brought in, it's usually very British. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but I don't like the idea of assumptions.
Yep.
So, for the next thing... Now, the Genesis system, which is the system that's used by Fantasy Flight Games' Star Wars RPGs, Genesis is just the universal version of it. They're putting out an expanded player's guide, and as part of that, they have put in a few sample settings.
Dude, what's up with that tower? Looks like Cabrini Green.
And let me open that up. So let's see what settings that we have. We have the World of Heroes, which, judging by the approach, it's definitely a high fantasy approach that is very clearly trying to replicate antiquity. And also, and given the fact that one of the Age of Myth weapons is the Bow of Apollo.
I don't know what's going on with me, because tried restarting the connection, didn't work. Tried restarting Discord, didn't work. Restarting the computer, didn't work. What the fuck is going on tonight? Seriously.
The second one is the World of Horror, which is not about monsters, but about the people who have become monsters in their hubris. And I'm sorry, but this piece of artwork that they have here, I can't unsee this as Uncle Phil conducting an experiment on a Kraken.
Now it's doing it more frequently. Jesus. Discord fucking hates me tonight.
Yes, it does. Okay, so that setting is known as Monster World. Let's see, and the World of Survival, which is going for more of the post-apocalypse approach. With a few archetype setups. I do like that they're showing this sort of thing to help demonstrate the flexibility of the Genesis system. Which I've kind of covered with the Star Wars RPGs, but the Universal version does some slight changes that I might have to dedicate its own video to. But it is a very good system. It's one that I can see some people be hesitant about because some people don't like custom dice, but that's the worst I can say about it. But speaking of the Star Wars RPGs, it was also announced that they're getting a source book dedicated solely to starships and speeders. And what I've begun to notice is that instead of doing expansions for the individual RPGs, they've been doing these black book expansions that are meant for all three games. You might think it seems a bit weird to have three different Star Wars RPGs all coming out by the same company, but here's what you have to keep in mind. Edge of the Empire is more your scum and villainy kind of campaigns. Age of Rebellion is self-explanatory. And Force and Destiny is also self-explanatory. The last bit from Fantasy Flight, and I will admit I'm a bit of a fan of this company, is for L5R 5th edition. We are getting a Ronin supplement called Path of Waves. I'm still waiting on that Mantis Clan book, Fantasy Flight Games. I know you're going to be focusing on Path of Waves, but come on, give me something to work with here. And Aaron, are you back yet? No, you are not. So the next one that we have as far as news goes, I have to thank Hairball for bringing this to my attention. Which is that Lieutenant Dan decided to take 1,000 children of fallen soldiers to Disneyland free of charge.
All right. Trying this one more time. If this is just keeps fucking up, I'm just gonna give up. Ridiculous.
I can hear you.
Ugh. Okay, so anyway. Lieutenant, oh! Gary Sinise, he's kicking ass again. Hell yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I of course, I'll always see him as Lieutenant Dan, but I do like that his foundation decided to help out a bunch of kids and send them to Disneyland. I may have my own beefs with Disney, but I'm going to put those aside for the sake of class.
Oh, definitely.
Yep. Apparently, over 1,750 kids.
Gee, that's a lot of kids.
Mm-hmm. And put up a flag for this photo. That's a lot of flags. If he put up 600 flags in Disneyland, damn.
Yeah, like I said, that guy's done. He's done a lot. He's done a lot for the troops. He's like one of their biggest boosters right there.
Mm-hmm. And I wonder if he actually played that guitar.
Probably did. I think he has like a sort of a band called the Lieutenant Dan Band, I believe.
Okay, that I can go with. And Exy is saying I'm dusting off my copy of Patton. But next, the meme continues on.
Yep.
A brewery prints Epstein didn't kill himself on the bottom of cans.
You know what?
Oh, God damn it. And
these fucking tech problems are really starting to piss me off, man. You know what? I'm going to sit out for a while, find out what the hell's going on. I'll be back later.
All right. So looks like for a little while, I'm running this thing solo. Yes, all the power is mine! Just kidding. So one California brewery decided to get into the meme business and started printing Epstein didn't kill himself on the bottom of their cans. The manager at Tactical Ops Brewing in Fresno said he got the idea about a week ago after seeing the memes flooding his Facebook feed. They'll be printed underneath the blue cans of Basher Oatmeal Stout. They're only releasing one batch of the cans, so that's probably going to be a few hundred bucks on eBay by the time I finish talking about it. The sauce is Tactical Ops Brewing. And I'm trying to figure out if the meme has gone too far or if we haven't gone far enough. Nah, I think we haven't gone far enough. Now for another case of restoring faith in humanity. So I was initially going to rip into what happened with the Shuri Castle in Okinawa. But after I saw this little thing, I decided no, that's not the case. And yeah, Hairball, Aaron's resetting his router or doing something. So I'm going to be running it solo until either he comes back or I get more backup. And where the hell? Oh, Flutter's on his phone. He's probably hanging out with his buddy. But anyway, shortly after the burn down, which the cause of it has not been stated. I know there was that whole thing about a tourist, but the people of Okinawa had managed to set up a crowdfund, and that has currently reached about 414 million yen. As of 3 days ago. And hang on, what the? Okay, that's an odd person to follow me. Anyway, if you'll give me a moment, I'm going to try and do a bit of conversion. So I don't usually mess around with yen. So that's 3.7 million dollars. And in fact, this is going to be an emergency times. Call for emergency solutions. So hang on a second. Wait a minute, Kyoryu, you're still in the States, aren't you? Or did you manage to get back home? I think that's the, and yeah, I already checked that hairball. It's about 3.8 million rounded up. Moving past that, I have a rare instance where I have to give 343 Industries some actual credit. So Brian Gerard has been getting some needles at him. Doku incoming in five. So I'm going to have to do a bit of fiddling. And oh, it's like 2209 EST. Let me see if I can do an emergency thing, because
okay, are you hopefully back? This works.
All right.
Because what happened was I had to restart my router.
Ah. Well, we're currently on the Master Chief issue, and Brian Gerard had to basically tell some of the community to calm down. We never outright set a release date for the Master Chief Collection yet. It'll be released when it's ready.
Oh God!
I'm giving them credit for this, because I would rather it be released when it's ready to go than have them rush it out.
Yeah, agreed. I mean, this isn't going to be like Duke Nukem Forever. No. You know what I mean? God, I hope not.
Plus, right now they're doing extensive testing for the PC version of Halo Reach. Because the thing you have to keep in mind is that they are putting out, because it's the most. Oh, and hey, I know that sound. And it's not there yet.
Nope, Doku, that's me.
Yeah, I thought Doku said he's coming in five. But the, considering that we're dealing with Halo 1, 2, 3, and Reach, and possibly including the Forge and all the multiplayer maps. Yeah, it's going to take a while before this thing comes out.
Oh, yeah. This is like, what, 5 games? Jesus.
Well, considering all the different playlists you can find in the various games, I don't think they're adding Halo 4. And of course, the other thing that might make things a bit tricky is they want to maintain some degree of crossplay with people who have the Master Chief Collection on Xbox One. So the way I see it, this isn't a case of we didn't put a release date because we're being lazy. It's a case of we've got a lot of shit to do. At least that's the way I'm looking at this.
Oh yeah.
But next. So Keanu Reeves actually apparently doubled his presence in Cyberpunk 2077 because he was having too much fun.
Oh. So he thought, okay, this should be a decent gig. Then all of a sudden he saw how CD Projekt Red rolls. Says, "Oh, you know what? I'm going to stay a while."
Mm-hmm. See, at Luca Comics and Games Festival, voice actor Luca Ward told journalists Gianluca Rocco that his recording time had been doubled thanks to his Canadian counterpart. Reeves was apparently enjoying himself so much he talked CD Projekt Red into giving the virtual rock star a bigger presence. He's not exactly starved for work these days, but extra work might be appreciated by the other voice actors playing Johnny Silverhand. So apparently because Reeves asked for more work, that meant that the voice actors for other languages got more work too.
Oh.
Which, I don't want to get conspiratorial, but do you think that might have been his plan?
I'm going to go, I don't know. To be honest, I don't know. But who knows? Maybe makes the game longer.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll certainly find out soon enough. So the next thing is we found out about a little game called IGI Origins. Which is being nicknamed the James Bond Simulator. And this is the first time that this series has been around since 2003. It was dead for a long time, but then the former devs got the rights back. And now Antimatter Studios is working on a prequel. It's likely to be a standalone experience, but let's see what they've got. Because they do have a bit of footage here.
Now the question is, who had the rights before they got it back?
I'll have to look into that later.
I'm probably thinking, one of the triple A's had it, and they decided to shelve that thing, like every other decent franchise. Mm-hmm.
But apparently some of the work that they've done in the intermediary is Rising Storm, which is very good, and the Killing Floor series, which is also pretty good. But this is basically a sizzle reel, and we'll probably get a proper gameplay footage down the line. But I'm not exactly seeing the James Bond in this yet.
Yeah, this is more Siphon Filter than James Bond.
Which I'm not complaining about, because when's the last time you got Siphon Filter?
Yeah, really. Sup, Doku?
I have a cat on my lap that needs to get off the fucking headphone cord.
Well, at least your tech problems are minuscule compared to mine and tonight, because turns out... Well, look, well... Turns out the damn thing's holding up after I restarted my router.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and also, Cat, get your fucking tail out of my face. I'm trying to drink a beer, you little bastard.
He loves you!
So Flutter is not the only person in the monastery who has pussy problems.
Apparently. Son of a bitch. First you're trying to eat my fried chicken from earlier tonight, now I'm trying to drink a beer and you got your fucking ass stuck in my face. Little fucking feline devil. Oh, and you throw up on the rug. You fucking...
Oh!
Good God almighty.
Damn it, Cat.
So...
Anyways, how the fuck are y'all doing?
I'm doing good.
Well, hopefully my damn connection holds up, because up until I had to restart my router, I was going in and out, in and out, in and out, in and out. Couldn't hear Mildred on fucking Discord, so I had to go in and out of the whole damn thing. Tried everything everything other than punt my monitor out of the window. Then I just restarted
Who's your ISP?
Calm crap.
I have the same, and I've been having the same fucking problem over the past couple of days where stream and shit will, like, just crap out whether I'm actively on the stream or just listening in.
Yeah,
so it's maybe right.
The problem is it's the router, because we had the Blackhawk router going, and we had zero problems, very little problems, and what the problem was, fucking cow crap decided to put our freaking our data limitation in, try to squeeze our data allowance, right? So to get that data allowance back, we had to use their router.
Bro, I had the same fucking problem. I guarantee you that's what the fuck it is, because I have a Blackhawk router myself.
Yep, and
Blackhawk routers are great, man.
And more on point. 20 words next time, 20 words or less.
Comcast sucks. There you go.
So
fuck Comcast.
I wanted to include this little story because I feel it provides a counter argument to Crunch. So Microsoft's Japan branch recently added 3-day weekends to their employees. Mm-hmm. And apparently that improved productivity quite a bit.
So you only work four days. Same as I do.
So they introduced the
other ball says drink for comp crap. Mildred, you have a beer?
Yeah, drink. Yeah,
I'll drink.
Still. Yeah.
But so apparently the new break had employees spend 20% less time at the office. However, they saw attendance improved by 25% and electricity costs reduced by 24%. Productivity increased by almost 40% as well.
Mm-hmm.
Despite, even though there is still the problem that Japan has the lowest job satisfaction rate in the whole damn world.
Well, of course, you work like, what, 40-hour days or something over in Japan?
Mm-hmm. Now, they also go into the fact that a labor law was implemented recently to try and combat high amounts of death by overworking due to its long storied history of too many hours expected of workers at these jobs and the refusal to allow time off for sickness and pushing people to their breaking points over and over.
Well, that's nothing new.
Yep.
And, of course, the first comment is, to the surprise of no one, not working your employees to death improves the quality of their work.
Yeah, don't work your guys like the slave, like a slave driver. This ain't the 1900s.
So,
well, you know, and to their credit, and granted, this was back when Google still had the slogan, don't be evil. But yeah, that's no longer a thing, as we know, but... Now, before they acquired YouTube and were under the Alphabet umbrella, back when Google was still Google, they tested out a thing with, employees got a 2-hour nap or recreational time right after, like, their lunch break. And they saw productivity increase by, like, 37% or some shit.
Yeah.
What's up, bitches?
Hello, hello.
What's up?
Hey there.
Oh, what's up, Shade?
We had just finished the story about the counter-argument to Crunch. Not our Crunch. Different Crunch.
Yeah, I figured.
But next we have the fact that...
3-day weekends.
Yep. That Octopath Traveler had Denuvo quietly removed on its Steam version.
Wow.
Ooh, good.
Well, it looks like you guys are in for the long haul. Good thing I'm here for the long haul tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Speaking of the long haul, Shades, you're one drink behind. Catch up.
Well, I'll tell you what, you guys, I'm one drink behind. I'm looking at the docket. I think we got one more story to add to the list to be one more. So you guys are one story behind.
I don't know, man. We're loaded up.
Yeah.
Yeah, I noticed. Yeah,
I saw your Move the Terminator story in there. So, like, yeah, that you're loaded up.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, I had a story planned up because San Francisco is being San Francisco, but we'll talk about we'll talk about that next week.
But apparently the Steam Store version hasn't updated the fact that Octopath Traveler is not using Denuvo. But the community forum has noticed that the game's files are smaller. It's almost like Denuvo isn't as effective as they'd like. Although, I do have to say that that the designers for anti-piracy with Borderlands 3 looked at Denuvo and said, "Hold my beer."
Yeah. Yeah, I still stand by the theory that fucking Bitchford wanted to piss gamers off. I mean, that's a surefire way to have your fans go sail the high seas.
They never learn.
Of course they don't.
And it eventually did get cracked, so no, they never learn. But I would have supported having Borderlands 3 cracked anyways, because the idea of setting up a virtual computer inside someone's system is something that is crossing the line.
That's creepy.
Mm-hmm. So next, hey, anybody remember Deep Down?
I don't.
Oh, who remembers?
I don't. Oh, boy.
Yep, so... Yoshinori Ono is claiming that even though the team that worked on that Deep Down project back in the PS3 days is gone, the IP is not completely given up on. Press X.
Oh, definitely press X. It's dead.
And I'll do you one better. That's a fucking drink.
Yeah, drink.
Yeah, you know what? Hold on.
Drink for dead dreams.
Yeah, you know what? Fuck it. Where's my thing here? Hit it, Sven!
It's after midnight and my show's a night light and I'm canceled. Movies are cheap and put viewers to sleep, so I'm canceled.
Ah, good old Sven Gulli.
All right. But when it comes to the big now, as far as I recall, Deep Down was a prototype name, a code name for a fantasy project that they were working on, with the details being scant. And then all that we heard of was last summer when the trademark was renewed by Capcom. So, but I don't know if that's the case, if they still want to do something with it, or they just don't want other people to take the name.
They're building all their shit on hopes and dreams at this point. Once I see something concrete, nah, that thing's dead as Dillinger.
They're building the on hopes and dreams, but unfortunately they forgot to save the game.
Yeah, really.
Oh. That one was for you, Shades.
Well, hey, you know, you could say you dream broken dreams.
Yeah.
Matty, that's your one.
Correctly.
What?
Mildred, if I remember correctly, isn't this the project that they were saying was supposed to be like a survival horror meets action fantasy? Is that the one they're talking about?
It could be. The problem is there was a lot of talk and not a lot of showing things.
Oh,
by the way, did I just hear you say that was my one?
Yes.
All hat, no cattle.
Aha.
But. And the first comment I think here is, I think one of the first comments from Swooty is on point here. It doesn't look that much different from Dragon's Dogma. Just give it a couple tweaks in some areas, stick it Suno in the directing chair, and there you go. Dragon's Dogma sequel. Don't let those assets go to waste. I agree. I like Dragon's Dogma.
Actually, no, that's a really valid point, and I second this motion. I agree. Like, I wouldn't mind a Dragon's Dogma sequel.
So, for the next thing, For those filthy heretics who like to be Gen 1ers when it comes to Pokemon, I think you'll appreciate this. A little project called Disc Creatures. Which is clearly trying to emulate Gen 1 era.
Oh,
with its
boy.
Own look,
yeah,
with its
clearly.
Own little spin. Although given the fact that they're using discs, I have to wonder if they're playing Monster Hunter as well.
I was just gonna say that.
No. You know, it would be Monster Rancher.
Oh,
yeah, Monster Rancher.
What the hell was I thinking?
Yeah, Monster Rancher.
Well, Monster Hunter is not a bad pick either, but it is Monster Rancher.
Not entirely sure about a three-person party like that. But apparently, they want to do skill trees for creatures. And I see what they're doing. They're having the old school three person party.
Oh,
but this is not bad for what's effectively a one man job.
Oh, only one person.
Mm-hmm.
That's not bad considering. Yeah, like I said. But then again, this is classic 8-bit, or more specifically, Game Boy 8-bit.
Yeah.
Even still,
close
for
enough,
one person,
close enough that's... for rock and roll in my book.
Mm-hmm.
Well, again, for one person, that's time and dedication, so this is either a labor of love or somebody paid you a lot of money for something.
Or they're completely insane. One of the three.
There's a Jim Ross joke in there, but I'm not going to do it.
Yeah, he's goofier than a pet coon.
Mm-hmm.
No, in reference to last night.
So next, now this is one game that's been on DS for the longest time that I've wanted to try out but never got around to. The Alliance Alive. And next January it's coming to PC.
Nice.
I remember hearing a lot of good things about Alliance Alive.
Huh, I've actually never heard of this one. So
this is
fresh news to me.
Apparently, it's also available on PS4 and Switch. I first found out about it when it was on the 3DS, and I had it on my list, but I just never got around to it. So next, let's talk a little bit about the My Shiranui situation.
Oh, here we go.
So,
oh boy.
When there was that really awesome video showing Terry Bogard heading to Smash, which was something that clearly Sakurai was passionate about, because I think he's made clear he's a fan of SNK Fighters. In fact, playing King of Fighters gave him the inspiration to lay the groundwork for Smash. But considering some of the other King of Fighters characters that are going to be making an appearance, one of which being Blue Mary, he said he had explained why he's not putting in Mai, and I understand why he did it. But the only problem that I have is how he worded it. the whole the game is for good boys and girls.
Ooh, yeah, that got memed in a hurry.
Yeah.
at least I got to see some great artwork out of it.
Again, I don't understand why you didn't put in it. I mean, come on. This is Smash is sort of it's got your general audience deal. That's understandable, but come on, don't be insulted. So what you're telling me is some jag-off dank pink hair is considered a good girl? Huh? Because if so, I will slap you.
There's one other reason I can understand it, because apparently they had to go through hell with ratings boards over Politina.
Oh yeah. And the ratings boards these days, they're starting to get a little pissy about
Well, he mentioned that the ratings board he had to deal with, who was giving him a hard time over that, was Cero.
Oh, those jagoffs!
Yeah,
that's not a surprise. And also, just because just for that particular name drop.
Yeah, fucking drink for Cero.
Drink.
Fuck Cero.
Now,
stupid ass censorious jagoffs.
Now, Team Ninja and Koei Tecmo decided to have a little fun at the whole thing. They had their Japanese studio had done a reply where they advertised the My DLC for Dead or Alive 6 and then said, "Welcome to the world of adults."
Cheers! That burn, damn.
Oh, that's a little bit of the bubbly.
Oh, the thing is, I can kind of understand why they would make this argument and not want to deal with it or change up the characters, because all of the Konnichi and the DOA series have always had a, shall we say, sexuality is a weapon. And
well, there's a reason for that, actually, because actually the whole part of the Konnichi setup is that they used their sex appeal to distract their enemies as part of their tactic. So it made sense, you know, even though clearly Koei Tecmo made them that way for, well, fan service, there is a actual reason why they would do that.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's a mix of column A and column B in that particular case, but
right.
I don't think Team Ninja intended any malice out of this. I think they were just having a bit of a crack.
Oh yeah, I'm sure they understand completely why Mai couldn't be in the game, but
yeah,
you know that doesn't mean they can't.
But don't yell out core values. Don't do that.
This has nothing to do with core values. And given what the Chinese have done to certain characters in King of Fighters 14's Chinese release. Yeah, you dodged the bullet there, people. Also, yeah, I do have to agree with Grayson Morales over here saying the Kirby version of Terry Bogard is the cutest thing ever.
Oh my god!
Yeah, like I said, you're not wrong. You're just a moron.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Mad Dog, he does not. Doku does not suck. Doku Madhawk is trying to call you out.
Oh, God, don't make me fucking fly over there to that side of the coast. I don't want to go anywhere near fucking Portland.
Put your motherfucking head back down!
This is to prevent you from having Doku pull out a sword at you.
Yep. We don't want any of that. So, then we had a bit of a horror game called Lust from Beyond, which is as stated that it's inspired by the works of Lovecraft, Giger, and Beskensky. I'm sorry if I mispronounced that name. And I'm definitely seeing the Giger in this. They put out a free...
Oh,
the game's
yeah.
not out yet, but they put out a free prologue.
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely.
I can see the Giger here.
There is an H.R. Giger influence for sure.
Yep. Oh, look at it. Look at one of the bullet points. Bold, erotic themes adapted to horror convention. Don't tell me we're gonna see tentacle porn in this.
Nope. We're gonna see worse.
Oh, worse? God.
Well, Well, Shades, you said it best. We've seen enough hentai to know where this is going.
Okay, yeah. Which of you three have played Dante's Inferno?
Me. I've played Dante's Inferno. This...
So it looks like we're going to... So you're seeing worse? Are we talking Vore? Oh, my God.
This looks like the third level of Dante's Inferno on steroids.
Not only that, that's lust. I have played the unrated version of Agony.
Oof.
Yeah, that's kind of the vibe I'm getting from this. Like, hey, you want to see some kinky stuff? You want to see some erotic stuff? Yeah, we're going to take all that and then we're going to give you nightmares using it. Have fun.
And this is why I'm glad that Rakti so far does not watch my show.
God damn it. No, you guys have not talked to Rakti, okay? I've had to talk to him in voice chats. That motherfucker's out of his goddamn mind.
Well, didn't he spam like three versions of Nekopara to you?
He gave me the whole fucking series.
He gave up. God damn.
He donated. He gifted me the entire Nekopara series, the entire Sakura series, and several other just outright trolly games.
That's Chinese water torture.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, he's that out of his goddamn mind. I don't say that with any hyperbole.
So
what didn't you like about Sakura?
I'm not one for those kind of visual novels.
Ah, fine. Go back to your Monster Girl quest.
Well, look at it this way.
Here we go.
They didn't give you Phantasmagoria, both of those games.
No.
Oh, God, I want to kill him.
So, anyway, back on the rails. So, we have a shooting slash called Riverbound that's heading to the Switch, which it's almost like somebody decided to do a hack and slash out of Minecraft.
Oh, yeah.
And I mostly say that because it's using voxels instead of pixels, which makes this one of the more sane games I've seen using voxels. Because I'm not playing Vanguard again. Just watch Mandalore's video of Vanguard, and you'll see why that thing is fucking weird. But I'd say this would be a nice little dumb fun kind of thing.
Oh, yeah.
Actually, I kind of like the, I know it's cartoonish, but the graphics are actually sort of amusing. I kind of like...
I didn't say the graphics were bad. I'm just saying it's very much a dumb, fun kind of thing.
Well, so, here's someone we haven't seen in a while.
Hello! What did I pop in on?
We're almost to the geeks. Don't worry.
Oh, we're in time,
hey,
buddy.
Hey
we're
there, Ace. Welcome back to the party after several months.
It's been a while. My apologies.
No worries, man. We are on Reborn Samurai Awakens, which is out 5 days ago.
Oh.
And I thought we had something interesting, but then I unfortunately have to be a fucking idiot because then I see what it's on. It's on PlayStation VR, so...
Damn.
Drake for VR.
This looks good, too. Like, I would play this.
Disappointing.
But
I don't have a problem with VR. I just can't fucking... I don't have the room for it.
For me, it's less... I don't have the room for it, and moreover, because of my playstyle. Nah.
Yeah, to me, like I said, I hate gimmicks. I hate stupid gimmicks like those. VR is one of them.
Although,
okay,
go
ahead, Mildred.
At least with the cutting that we do here, I expect somebody to supercut Rules of Nature to it.
Please?
Yeah, okay, so I tried doing the whole, Oculus Rift thing with that, what was it, Eve Valkyrie?
Oh god, no.
Yeah.
I can tell you right now, that's a bad idea. It suffers from what I like to call IMAX syndrome. And high action does not bode well when you have to crane your neck around like a madman to keep track of it. Mm-hmm. Hence, any action movie in an IMAX setting.
Okay, so I'll explain this to you. My dogfighting style in Star Citizen is that I put the interceptor into a constant roll so that the enemy can't hit me, and I don't take off the accelerator, I only use the space brake. That is my strategy when it comes to dogfighting in terms of space games, which is normally perfectly fine. Except I like to drink a lot and play video games, and it's VR. Concussions aren't fun.
By the way, just to follow up on what we were talking about earlier, I posted the council all the games Rakdai gifted me on Steam.
Yeah, let's see here.
And like posted, at least he's giving you shit.
Shit, I'll never play.
Ultimate Fishing Simulator?
Yeah!
I'm going to agree to disagree about Mother Russia Bleeds being under stupid games.
Well, look at it this way. He didn't give you Big Rig's Over the Road Racing.
Oh God.
Enjoy Big Rig's in a ironic way. Because
yeah, you get winning. That game, you are obligated to fucking stream it, record it, whatever.
Mm-hmm. That applies. All right, so, but now that we've gotten the news out of the way, it is time for the real shit.
Oh, here we go. Yeah.
Good Brother Shades, lay us in as we begin the drinking.
Ladies and gentlemen, the bar is open. It's time for Mildred the Monk's Geek of the Week.
And with that, ladies and gentlemen, you know what to do. It is time to rise for our drinking.
All rise!
Yep.
Skull! Skull!
Where's my liquor?
Skull! Skull!
Skull!
Sound the yellow horn!
You know, I know it's a thing, but just thought popped in my head, just play a clip from Monty Python. Get on with it!
As much as Thorkell loves axes and Thorfinn loves revenge, we love fucking drinking and laughing at idiots, so crack open the fucking beers.
Koryu's got 12 bottles of cider prepared. Oh, God.
Jesus Christ, Koryu!
By the way, speaking of Yallerhorn, your boys are beating Duke Booth!
Yep, end of third quarter.
Dude, I saw that video of Amari Cooper's touchdown. Jesus Christ.
I didn't see it.
You're probably going to see
it's
clips
on Bleacher
of a
Report.
You're probably going to see clips of a certain one-handed catch.
Well, one-handed with two toes in the end zone. Mm-hmm.
But anyway, now this particular instance, I had first covered when it was brought up on the Stream of Corruption with Lord Nurgle.
Oh yeah, I listened to that podcast. Ugh.
So
no fucking simpy.
So FaZe Jarvis, a member of FaZe Clan, as if we hadn't ripped into those guys anytime soon, and. Mad Dog, no, I did not see the KRS and Paul fight because if I want to watch a fight, I'll watch UFC. But more on point. Jarvis, this 17-year-old streamer had done a stream showing an aimbot that he had found, and Epic put the gavel down hard on him and gave him a lifetime ban. He does this crying video, and I am going crocodile tears, bitch. Now, I will admit one thing. If he was granted leave to do some sort of private server thing, I don't think this would have been as much of an issue, because it's a private server.
Yeah.
Yeah.
but doing it on a public one. I don't know if he was doing this on full on Battle Royale or doing this on a team gig, but the fact that he did it live like that. The reason why Epic was going to go so hard on that is because if other people start using that aimbot and they're not doing it in a means to show kind of thing, that could cause more problems for the community. And considering all the hacker problems I've had with older FPSs and some of the hackers that I've had to deal with in CS:GO, the only thing that I have to say on the matter is I do think a one strike and you're out policy is a little bit extreme, and I've never been a fan of zero tolerance policies because they remove nuance, like what happened with that security guard we talked about 2 weeks ago. What I think should have happened is Epic should have pulled the guy and said, don't fucking do this again. If you do this again, you're out. No questions.
Yeah.
I think he should have.
That's stupid. Use your common sense.
But honestly, I fully agree with you, Mildred. Until the second half of this story.
Oh yeah, and then Ninja gets involved and tries to make a full campaign out about it. Ninja.
And then, go fuck yourself, Ninja.
Seriously, Ninja.
Put your motherfucking head back down.
I mean, you're not annoying. You're not like annoying like all the other assholes we cover on here. But seriously, he fucked up.
No,
I'm sorry, Ace. Can I go in and let you go real quick?
Go right ahead.
Okay, homie. I can understand people saying like, okay, yeah, he should have gotten a warning and everything. This is my stance on it. Was it a bit of a fucking hammer? Yeah, you went fucking full on Mjolnir on this dude. But at the same time, bro, you're old enough to drive a car. How did you not think this was a bad idea? Like,
yeah, really?
Yeah. No, here's the thing. He even knew. He knew this was a bad idea, because he even says in the video because I've seen clips of him doing of this incident. He even said, "I'm probably gonna get my account banned." He figured his alt account, the account he had made specifically to use the same bot, was gonna get banned. He didn't expect his main account. Yeah, he didn't expect to get IP banned. His main account permaband. That was what he was counting on.
Oh boy!
But again, this is a big fucking deal, and especially coming from one of the most popular groups in gaming right now. FaZe is very well known, especially with a lot of the controversies they've already been dealing with. He should have known they were already on thin ice to begin with. This was way too fucking risky.
Yeah, what he lacked right now, and I think most 17-year-olds do, is they lack a key toward concept. And that concept is called situational awareness. Did you really think this shit was going to happen? You know, Epic does not tolerate cheaters. I mean, with all their faults, there's one thing that they're doing well: stopping cheaters. And if you fuck up once, even if it's for a gag, you're screwed.
So, if I may,
should know better.
One, Ninja, go fuck yourself. I don't give a shit whatever excuse you give this guy. Two, yes, he shouldn't understand the ramification of his actions. Three, I am expecting Epic to go back on this in under a week and say, oh, we're so sorry. Four, part of this story, ruining a content creator's life for this. Okay, one, this guy's a Fortnite streamer. He's not going to have to worry about money for a long fucking time. Two, he's part of FaZe. They pay them out the ass to do this shit. Again, no worries about money. I have no tears to shed for this little fuck's sake.
Like what Ralph said on Stream of Corruption, better get the bag and groceries, you little bastard.
Well, actually, you guys want to laugh real quick?
Yeah.
Please.
Guess how I actually heard about this? Because I didn't hear about it from YouTube. I didn't hear about it from Twitter.
You'll never guess
how I heard about this.
Where?
I fucking had a dentist appointment for just a routine cleaning. and the chick that does my cleaning. We were talking about YouTube, and it's like, oh, yeah, I'm on a few live streams every now and then. We bullshit and everything. She goes, oh, did you hear about the Fortnite kid?
And, that's how I found out about it. This has gotten so bad that some of my...
brought you up to speed on that?
This has gotten so bad that some of my coworkers who are normies found out about that. And I had a few people contacting me on the on Skype asking me, and I, look, it's not the Skype that I use here. It's a specific Skype for my office about... about my weighing in on the whole Fortnite thing. Now I had already known about it, but it was a bit astounding to me that it gotten such traffic that people outside of the know found out about it.
Oh my god!
Yeah, bro. Wow. Literally, I'm there getting the water scrubber thing that they use on like your gums and shit, and I'm sitting there with my mouth fucking wide open trying to figure out what to watch on Netflix because my dentist is fucking amazing and I can watch Netflix while I'm sitting there at the dentist office.
But like I
which
said,
is a brilliant idea. But like no, she's sitting there sorry, real quick. She's sitting there fucking talking to me about like YouTube and shit, and she mentions this story and explains it to me, and I fucking literally choke on the fucking fluoride. I couldn't stop laughing. It's like, bro, I'm sitting there, I'll try to recreate. I was literally sitting there with my mouth open like, are you fucking kidding me? What the fuck? What the fucking dog? You stupid little bitch shit.
Well, you know what? Like I said, no fucking simpy.
No
simpy.
Bro, it was funny. Even my fucking dentist knows about this shit.
That's how badly you fucked up.
Yeah. Take your L and go home. You're done.
Up, dude, is public knowledge. You are fucked.
I mean,
good luck getting
invited
to tournaments.
In a way, I'm actually kind of impressed. Like, you managed to fuck up so badly that... You know, I'm sure Brian Stelter fucking knows about how badly
you
fucked
up.
You know,
and also, like I said, and I think someone also mentioned this on Streaming Corruption, that, you know, if Epic let this go, say he goes to a tournament, these people will be a little bit skittish to play with him.
A little bit, yeah.
There was also that, and it would also set a bad precedent. I think that was, mm-hmm. I think Epic was thinking long ball with this, so... I may roast their store over an open fire on a weekly basis, but I'll give you this, and although your whole exclusivity thing is still bullshit, and now it's time for the threefold thing, because China, because of the fact that for this we have a Florida man and two Florida adjacents, so we have
Florida man.
So because of this, and I'm saying this in advance, we do not have a mere tank bowl. We have a super tank bowl.
Yes!
Tank bowl!
Oh, and just looking at this article. Oh!
Listen here. I don't like the New York Times. They publish crap, okay? But deny library subscriptions. Hell, some people read it for just sheer comedy.
I'm just gonna put this out here right now. I'm looking at them from left to right, and it looks like Jimmy Smith and Brian Coleman here look like they're holding in a shit.
Two words, friend. Ex-lax.
Now, look,
oh God! Real quick, Mildred. Sorry. If any of you artists out there listening to us get bored for situations like this in particular, go ahead and Google what a Bane Blade looks like because we need to radio Mars. We need a full division of those damn things for these types of instances.
Yeah. Do you remember what happened the last time someone radioed Mars? Haven't you played Soulstorm?
Yeah.
Oh, hey, you know what? I kind of happen to like Reaver and Warlord types, so I'm not complaining.
Now I can understand why they don't want they don't want to spend the $2,700 annually for this shit, because I'm a proponent of not giving people money that hate you. I understand that, but like I said, some people need comp. Some people read that shit for comedy.
Well, for me personally,
it's not the result; it's the reasoning.
Yeah, one, it's the reasoning. Now, yes, the New York Times is trash. No one's going to deny that. Here's my issue. Banning does not solve anything.
Mm-mm.
No matter what site it is, no matter how hard it is. Has nobody learned from Prohibition?
Of course not.
It's been almost 100 years and people still haven't learned the damn lesson.
They never
seriously.
They haven't learned the lesson from Prohibition, they'll never learn.
And there's a bunch of women in spring.
Maddie cut off.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
You're cutting out, Maddie.
Check 1, 2. 1, 2, 3.
All right, you're good.
Sometimes my computer does that to me.
Okay, so...
Anyway, you're saying.
Back to your point.
I was making... There are some women in Springfield going, "We want Prohibition! We want Prohibition!"
Man's not wrong.
All right. It did not hit. Okay.
So... But then, we ended up getting some more stuff. Now this is a case of, and
oh yeah, Louisiana man.
Yep, we got some stupid coming. We got some stupid coming out of Cajun land.
Oh, I heard about this one.
Yeah, up on a shopping cart so you can avoid a DUI.
I read about this.
Bold strategy, Cotton. Let's see how this pays off.
Wow.
Spoiler alert, it doesn't.
And the animal shocker is saying, so how long till Fedora come back in style? I don't know, I rock one pretty good.
That's actually our buddy Voice. Yeah, mm-hmm. Nice one, Voice.
Don't go knocking me wearing my suit, because if you do that, we're going to have some problems.
And when you got problems, you're going to have a bad time. Mm-hmm.
So, the Terrebonne Parish Sheriff's Office said it responded to a bar along Corporate Drive in Houma around midnight after getting a report that someone had shown up in the parking lot riding the stolen cart. He stole an electric shopping cart.
Oh my god.
Putting aside the fact that those shopping carts move at the speed of litigation. It's like... And he parked
by the way, speaking of fedoras, check counsel. And also drink.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, God, what have you done? What have you done?
Ah, nice.
Fedora, man. Brim's too small, though.
Yep.
So you have a point.
He was booked on one count of unauthorized use of a movable. His bond was set at $2,500.
Yeah.
But
that's not that bad.
It's not that bad.
He
admitted that he stole it from Walmart. Of all things, Walmart.
Well, look at it this way. It wasn't a DUI, so he sort of succeeded.
He's still sort of going being the fucking operative jail. Part there. Right?
He still ended up in jail, but it's only like what, a misdemeanor instead of a fucking felony.
He's still a drunk fucking idiot. Yeah.
At the same time, though, I would not be surprised if he's gonna have whiskey plates on for the next few months.
Fair enough. I want to answer Animal Shocker in the chat real quick. What hasn't been stolen for a getaway vehicle yet? My guess is going to be a horned crane.
Just give it. Well, it's not going to be me because it. I'd probably try and use a forklift solely so I can make the MST3K reference.
Oh,
whiskey plates. I see. Oh, you got those in Minnesota. We have to put like a W on there.
No, it's white plates.
White plates, huh?
I think there might be a W, but
God, here's Karma coming back to bite someone in the ass.
Rick, you kept jinxing about a Kansas man. Congratulations, this is your fault.
Well, be careful what you wish for.
Ladies, there's only one thing I gotta say. Toto, I don't think we're in Kansas anymore.
But in the meantime, shame him.
Shame.
Yeah. Ring the bell.
Yeah, ring in the fucking bell.
Shame. Shame. Shame.
He's actually happy about it.
So now I had to check to make sure everything was on point. But so he robbed a bank last September and told police he was hoping to get caught so he would get prison time to escape his wife. Was sentenced on Tuesday to 6 months of home confinement after pleading guilty.
Oh, damn.
Probably shouldn't have revealed that little factoid there, buddy.
Yeah.
Oh, bro. Fucking drink.
Wait, so you got depressed after a heart surgery, so you decide to rob a bank. What? How? Why?
You okay there, Vegeta?
I think I just had an aneurysm out of your stupidity.
Most of you've seen Goodfellas, right?
Yes.
There's a scene where Henry Hill basically said nobody goes to jail unless they want to. I think that proves the theory right there.
Okay, yeah, hold on. How is this not a rise?
Because bro.
No,
because we're not done yet. So he handed a note to a teller in Kansas City demanding cash and warning he had a gun. He took $2,924. You're going with a bank and you're only grabbing $2,000? And went to sit in the lobby where he told a guard he was the guy he was looking for. Now it's a rise.
Yep, definitely.
Let's go.
God damn it.
Where's my liquor?
Seriously.
This is good. I like this.
I mean,
skull.
When does that ever work? Adding someone a message to rob a bank, huh? Are you supposed to come in with a gun drawn?
This is hilarious.
You know, this beats out a situation that happened, I don't know when, probably about 10 years ago, when some idiot came into a convenience store and tried to rob it with a goddamn palm frond.
Ugh.
Yep.
You know what? Screw it.
Degenerates like you belong on a cross.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not arguing with that.
Actually, hold on. I got one better. We need to call Leonard Snardon on this.
There are only four rules you need to remember. Make the plan, execute the plan, expect the plan to go off the rails, throw away the plan.
Dude, what happened to this guy? That's exactly what happened.
Well, he wanted jail time. He should have been more specific.
Yeah, really.
No,
don't
problem is, no. The problem was, he was too specific.
Idiot.
Yeah. Yep.
So now we have a case of Darwin Award, or
here we go.
Play stupid games, win stupid prizes.
Now, it can't be a Darwin Award because...
Can I just ask why Bob Barker? He's a legend. Put Drew Carey in there.
It wasn't. Okay, yeah, that meme, that's not a snipe at Bob Barker at all. Okay? That's basic. That's basically that. Play stupid games, win stupid prizes. I figure Bob Barker, I like to imagine it's Bob Barker pointing and laughing at you.
Ah, this is not the way he smiles in that. Yeah, that makes sense.
Now, I am not going to.
Think of it as a pricing game, but a lot stupid.
Now, real quick,
Mildred.
Oh, so so the original Bullseye. Hey, gotcha.
Hang on.
Yep.
Doku.
Mildred, what are we looking at on screen? And how many more beers do I need to go pull out of the fucking garage?
Let's be honest. You both know that you and I both know that Nurgle would hit it.
Oh, of course he would, but that's Nurgle.
Oh, the Tatooine meets Darwin. Yeah, get a 2-4.
I wouldn't say Darwin technically because A, she's not dead.
Honorable mention.
She's still fertile. What was that?
Honorable mention.
It's honorable mention, but like I said, she's still fertile and she's not dead, so.
She's an idiot, yeah, but though. would you want to reproduce with it? Is this worthy of procreation?
No.
Nah.
Define reproduce.
No, because I'm afraid that all that ink would get on me.
Yeah, really.
But seriously, she
probably bleeds tattoo ink.
Trying to tattoo your eyeballs? What?
Actually, that's been a thing for a while now, and I don't know why. But
oh, I know it's been a first. I know it's been a thing. I know it's been a thing for a while, but just. Stupidity. I'm not opposed to tattoos, but whenever I see somebody who's just covered in more tattoos than actual skin, I'm like, I'm not going near that.
Yeah, buddy. The only excuse you have if you get your whole body tattooed is if you're in the fucking Yakuza.
And even they don't go that. At least with Yakuza tattoos, that there's at least thematics plus. Knowing how classical Japanese tattooing goes, if you're willing to go through that for that long, you deserve all the props. Because the thing is, there's no machine use. You have this tiny ass spear full of ink that gets jammed in you slowly.
Yeah.
Or if you're going really badass with it, and specifically, okay, I'm gonna flex my knowledge of Japanese, specifically Yakuza history, the more red ink you have, the more badass you are, because you're only allowed to get red ink for, consider it a badge of honor, so you have to have some kind of achievement, and the red ink, the way it's made, is poisonous, so it takes a long-ass time to fucking do, and the way they do it is they take a horsehair brush and a little wooden mallet, and it's a tap, tap, tap. Yeah, that shit hurts. Mm-hmm. But this, on the other hand, is like...
tacky.
Bro, it looks to me like you're really desperate for attention. Oh, by the way, drink for desperation.
Yep. Oh, definitely.
Delicious desperation.
Speaking of people being a fucking idiot, let's talk about the retail guy. So, MVideo got fined a warehouse employee tried to take a copy of Death Stranding a few days early from the store's stock to play it early. They got fined 1 million rubles, or $15,600.
Jesus.
Oh, damn.
$15,000? Damn.
And you want to know how he got busted? People looked at his PlayStation Network profile.
Idiot!
Oh,
idiot!
You all right there, Doku? You choking over there?
I was trying to drink right as I heard the reason, and yeah, I choked a little bit. Yeah, like, wow, you fucking dumbass,
John. Where's Eli Drake?
yeah, where's that button?
Oh,
here it is,
Dummy.
You fucking numpty!
We'll go that one, actually.
Marty's girl, but that works as well.
Yeah, that's right. That's right, Homer. Suka blyat!
Suka blyat!
Oh, my God. Drink for dumbassery.
Yeah. It's like...
Absolutely.
You could not wait a few days and just get the game then. You had to try and do it early.
What? Motherfucker, be thankful you're not a PC guy like I am. You gotta wait for a while for that shit, but I don't mind.
Dude, look at the fucking reviews, man. Come on. It ain't worth it.
Yeah. Wait a while. Jesus.
So next we have the formerly known as ACH, NXT's Jordan Miles, who's decided to go full stupid.
Fact oh, is, crap.
Does anybody have that button from Tropic Thunder?
Oh, yeah. Wait. The bridge?
Not the bridge.
Full retard.
No, don't have that one.
You just went full retard. Never ever go full retard.
You just went full retard. Never go full retard.
So
I am Sam went full retard. Lost his crew.
So, for a bit of background, Jordan Miles had a certain T-shirt put out for him that he was very much offended by and compared it to blackface. And
we should show the shirt for context here because, in fairness to Mr. Miles, in this case, he's not 100% wrong on the shirt.
Now let me see if I can. All right,
because we covered the shirt debacle on the WrestleCast, and T-Dub and I are in agreement went for that shirt for sure. But
now
you put that on the council, please.
I'm going to put it on the thing, and I don't usually cover wrestling related stupidity, but this was a special case. But yeah,
the gimmick is as Jordan Miles likes to smile a lot, and basically the red logo should look like a smile with the name looking like teeth. That's the idea behind the shirt.
Well, the thing is, he's not wrong about the shirt if he approached it from the idea of it's intentionally trying to mock me. The way he went about it and his reaction to it is kind of what makes him look like a fucking idiot.
This is something where he really should have handled this internally instead of trying to start a hashtag and all that. But then he decided to double down, and this was where I decided to get pissed off. Where he decides to try and call Jay fucking Lethal and Uncle Tom.
Oh, really? Fucking drink.
Well, I'm glad I grabbed those beers.
In the tweet picture. I want the TV belt. One day it will be mine. One day it will be mine.
Yeah, Jay Lethal was an absolute gentleman to me when I had met him, and he's one of the people who was willing to sign my belt.
Yeah, another thing, it's like. And here you go. Here's this guy. He says, name another African American who reached great heights other than this Uncle Tom. Oh, let's see here. Kofi Kingston.
He's talking about ROH, not WWE.
ROH, Jay Lethal, and if you want to stretch it, one of the Briscoes, if at that.
But even with that, it's one of those no win situations, because if he was having his way and pushing somebody as the top guy so we can have the brownie points of black champion, That would be an even worse move, because then you're not pushed, because we have seen what happens when somebody gets pushed in a spot that they shouldn't be in.
Yep. Anyone remember Jinder Mahal?
Oh.
I'm gonna go one step further back. The Lex Express.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Mr. LLC, but
abso-goddamn-lutely.
Ooh. Hello,
OSW Review. You're not watching this right now.
You know what? Free advice to anyone that has a significant public presence. When something like this happens and it makes you upset, okay, you can say, you know what? This pisses me off. I don't care. Go ahead and buy the shirt. It's free fucking publicity, and then wear it the next time you make a public appearance and make some fucking money off of it. It's free fucking publicity, dude. The woke outrage approach to things just makes you look like a whiny little bitch.
And I do like one of the comments here saying, "Well, there goes his career."
I rest my case.
If he had just stopped at the T-shirt, he would have been fine.
Oh no, dude! Fuck that.
I had to go woke, so now he has to go broke.
No, and, dude! Fuck that. Also,
in the comments, there's a few other people that are being brought up in the comments for this whole thing. And the guy who brought up this whole thing had stated, "Look, I understand where you're coming from, but calling Jay Lethal and Uncle Tom is going a step too far. But let's not forget that one of the most entertaining underdog slash comedy characters out of ROH was the skinniest man I've ever seen, Cheeseburger,
who's an absolute gentleman, by the way.
Yeah.
Here's where I want to go with this one. If he had two shits for brains, here's what you would have done. Buy the T-shirt, wear it to your next public appearance, rip it off, and then pretend to wipe your ass with it and throw it on the fucking ground. And then, there you go. You made your statement without making yourself look like a fucking whiny little piece of shit pussy. Yeah.
So, here's the thing, though, Doku. This is WWE.
Yeah.
That would have made it even better.
Yeah.
No, but here's the thing. One of those moments, he's out of a job.
Yeah.
I have to agree with Homer that he should have stayed in Japan and taken Taguchi's offer.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Once you get into the WWE, that's when you really start to. I mean, you better hope to God you don't get shipped to Raw or SmackDown.
But I digress.
If he had shut the fuck up, he would have had a nice spot on Wednesday nights.
However, now,
I have.
By the way, boys,
back on the rails.
That was the warm up.
Yeah, that was the warm up.
Speaking of rails, I see a train coming.
Oh my God!
What? No, all aboard?
No need, because it's about to get But wait, it's better.
Uh oh!
Wow, not even gonna let me do my own
thing. Yeah.
Oh, I freaked out.
Oh, yeah. Aaron, you saw this?
Really?
Get out of there!
Hang on. We have one wrestler being a fucking idiot, and then we have another wrestler being a fucking idiot.
Now, Monk, you have to allow me to do this. You could read the whole statement, but I gotta open this up.
Good,
because he's going after one of my boys.
He is. Let me set the stage before I give you the floor. So, recently they did NXT did an invasion angle on SmackDown. And
basically SmackDown, most of the SmackDown crew were stuck in Saudi Arabia because of the shit show.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And one of the main matches involved Adam Cole, Bay Bay. And actually did a real damn good job because Adam Cole. Yeah,
let's put it this way: Adam Cole versus Daniel Bryan is something that should not fuck up, and it was awesome.
But not everybody agreed. And this is where superstar Billy Graham decided to open his mouth again.
Oh no!
He goes on his actual Facebook. I have verified this, and in no uncertain terms, says Adam Cole should take steroids.
Drink.
Drink!
Really, Billy?
You know. He did this with Kofi fucking Kingston. He's done this with countless other guys. And he still has... This is the same guy. Dual hip replacement surgery. Liver after goddamn liver transplants. This guy's on a constant deathbed because of his steroids abuse. And here he is. Nah, he needs to bulk up. Give him some steroids.
Oh, my God. Have they noticed that some wrestlers even died over this? May I mention one of those incidents happened to be the Whiff of Air, a.k.a. Chris Benoit.
Well, you got to remember, has Billy Graham died of it? No. So, of course, he's going to recommend him.
And besides, but here's the thing.
Here, actually, let me add one more thing, because there's something that I think Billy Graham doesn't realize. Something that he has completely forgotten. WWE will never let them use fucking steroids after the scandal.
Yeah, remember that wellness policy? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, banned substances. Are banned substances? Mm-hmm. Steroids.
Let's see. There was the medical ring incident in the 2000s. There was the steroid incident in the late 80s and that other scandal that
dropped. That was actually the early 90s.
Yeah, early.
It was early 90s. Yeah.
Early 90s that ended up basically putting the promotion on a near death spiral.
Yeah.
Plus the fact that Hogan decided to lie on national television,
aka be a fucking idiot.
But his argument of small guys, here's the thing. Back in the 80s, people in the general public didn't know shit about fighting or the fight culture. They are more aware of that nowadays. Especially with all the gradual exposure that international styles have gotten, and especially with the influence that MMA has on wrestling, and believe you me, it has an influence on wrestling. It has for the last decade.
I.e., submissions before MMA happened were always verbal, or quote unquote, the referee said ring the bell after a sharpshooter was applied. Mm-hmm. From 99, pretty much ever since Ken Shamrock came in, submissions were singled either by the three arms down, which is the traditional way, or the tap out. Yeah, that's really. MMA right there.
Mm-hmm.
Look no further.
But he's
done this now with Adam Cole. He's done that with Finn Balor, Seth Rollins. Any generally small guy who has a weight of 200... of over 205 pounds, which in MMA is heavyweight.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy says, take steroids. He needs to bulk up. He has refused to evolve. And
yeah, his mindset's stuck in the 70s.
I'm going to stay on Billy Graham because this guy abused steroids. He's admitted this.
Yeah,
he lost the liver. He's lost his hip.
Yeah, I would say he was taking steroids like he was popping Skittles.
Basically.
Mm-hmm.
And he's telling the kids who are working for a company who has a policy that bans steroids in human growth for hormones for that exact fucking reason.
Even if it wasn't banned, I think most wouldn't do it simply because the expectation on performance is so much higher these days than it was 30 years ago. Especially
well, real,
especially since you have a lot of these people who are going into Japan, and you can't just pose and then do a leg drop in Japan. That's just not going to work.
No.
Yeah,
it's not going to work.
Yeah.
Now, in fairness, if you have a look, like there are a couple of young lions who look like they were built out of stone. Yeah, before they had to quit due to a couple of bad injuries. But they looked like they were ready to go, and they could actually go. So if you have a body, like Brian Cage, for example, is a good example here. If you have a body, that's a plus. But if you can go, like if you can actually wrestle, that's what counts. Yeah. Billy Graham forgets that that's what matters.
Yeah. In fact, I think you probably know this, Maddie, but for those of you who are new to the game, Hogan did not have a leg drop as his finisher when he wrestled in Japan.
No.
Wait, real quick. The first drink was for making a stupid statement. Make that two drinks for stupid statement and also lack of self-awareness. Drink of course. Again.
Agreed. Yep.
Apparently,
yeah. Who did you ask? Is that you got, actually, you cut off there, actually, when you were asking who was in Japan or not.
Hogan. He was talking about Hogan.
Hogan was in Japan, actually.
Yeah, no, he's saying he was. He
didn't use the leg drop when he was in Japan.
Yeah, I believe his move in Japan was a lariat.
It was a lariat called the Akshabumba!
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I do have to laugh at the fact that after this he shills his GoFundMe because apparently he's been having heart problems.
At the end of the post, link for GoFundMe for surgery.
Oh, you fucking course. Idiot. Drink.
Yep. Yeah, drink.
So there's something I noticed about Billy Graham after all of these because thanks to you, Maddie, and many other things, I noticed all these explode in his face. But at the same time, the way he is, until someone he actually gives a shit about tells him to stop, he's never gonna. He is at that age where he is, and like, to not use vernacular that I'm really getting tired of hearing, but is going to be stuck in our culture for the next year. He is of that age range where, yeah, the world doesn't pertain to me anymore.
Yep.
And the sad thing is, nothing will ever change that mindset. Mm-hmm. So he will say what he wants, and until it has some kind of ramification towards him, it will never change.
Yeah.
And I'm going to say, get used to hearing it, because it's probably not going to be the last time we hear him say something like it.
It probably won't, but this will be the last time that he ends up gracing my temple.
Yeah.
Anyway.
This was one of those, like, I had to because Adam Cole is legitimately one of my favorite professional wrestlers to watch. And the fact that he's developing so well and getting that much flack from a guy who should know better, just, I read that and I was so fucking mad all afternoon when I read that.
Getting back on the rails, folks. By the way.
Get back on the rails!
Did it? Your boy just beat them boys.
Oh yeah. How about them cowboys?
How about them cowboys?
So next up, we have the fact, and I had labeled this as simply threat.
Yeah.
A reboot of the Mighty Ducks? No.
Fact,
I need the button from How Not to Summon a Demon Lord.
I had a feeling I was already prepping it.
Nope. No times no divided by no to the power of oh hell no.
Yeah, just...
Good God.
Absolutely not.
And you know what? What's funny? I mentioned this earlier, and I have a feeling they're going to... For Emilio Estevez's role... Because it would make sense, considering that he was in another Mighty Ducks film, they're probably going to give him to Juicy Smoulier.
Oh,
famous French actor.
There we go again.
Yep. Would make sense.
Well, everybody's been trying to... Some of my coworkers have been trying to talk me into giving Disney Plus and look, and I'm like, the only thing they have in there that is remotely interesting to me, and I may end up sailing the high seas for it, is The Mandalorian, because I am not buying a service for one show.
Agreed.
Same.
And then there
was
actually,
I'll give you a little, Mildred, I'll give you a little bit of pushback there. I actually do like the idea of a show with Falcon and the Winter Soldier. If treated properly, that could be really good.
You realize it's caveat, not.
I don't think it's going to be good.
That's the thing. I don't trust them. Now,
and that's the thing. Disney Plus, yeah, all the movies. Are they showing all the movies they have on their library? No. Matter of fact, that library they got from 20th Century Fox is going to be bought to be benched.
Yeah, and not only that, I've mentioned that was Disney's endgame. They're basically trying to buy up a movie company so they can sort of vault every last good movie that's been released before their garbage took over. Mm-hmm. But the crazy part is, these movies. Yeah, go ahead.
The crazy part is they can literally just do what the WWE Network does. Mm-hmm. Everything up there, and every once in a while you update, you add a few other things in there, but you have this massive library of back catalog, and not only yours, but all the movies and the Star Wars franchise and all the other movies and the 20th Century Fox back catalog. Put it up there. Make some fucking money off it.
Yep. They're not gonna. You want to know why? It makes their shit look worse. And number two, and this is, and I want
Aaron,
to talk about
Rails.
This. Rails.
Oh, for God's sake.
We're going to be here all night at this rate.
So let's take a bit of time to laughing at Emma Watson. Again. With the idea that I'm not single. I'm not single. I'm self-partnered. So you're a narcissist. If you're self-partnered, you're outright admitting that you are in a relationship with your own reflection.
Oh,
that is exactly what happened with narcissists.
Here's the problem. You want to know what the problem is? You're about to hit 30. You know what that means, right? You're about to hit the wall.
How many drinks is this? Because I don't know.
But
a lot.
All of them.
I do like that because of this, she's basically admitted to being an incel. All
right, it's three drinks. Female incel, self-partnered.
And claiming it's a redefinition.
Sweetie, let me explain something to you, sweetie. Maybe it's because you're insufferable. That's why.
Maybe it's because everybody keeps playing that little speech you made at the UN all those years ago.
Yep.
It was like, I don't understand why feminism is associated with man hating. It's like, sweetie. Like if you don't understand it. Then ask around. Do some actual research.
Yeah, don't be insufferable.
And there it is.
Cunt.
Mildred?
Yep.
How many... I believe that's four drinks. And we haven't even really gotten into this. Who wants to kill their liver tonight?
Are you suggesting we rise?
I'm definitely suggesting that we skull.
Yep, it's a rise.
Skull. Where's my liquor?
Skull. Skull. Skull.
Skull.
Skull! 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 Kill your livers, everyone! Here we go!
Salvia!
Happy fucking Sunday!
Yeah, here's the thing. Here's my comment on this, okay? You know why people associate feminism with man-hating? It's not because all feminists are man-haters. No. We're not going to play that card. No. But it's pretty common knowledge that almost every single man-hater is calls themselves a feminist.
Amen.
And not only that, male feminists? Woof.
Reset the fucking clock.
Yep.
This is why.
God damn it, cat.
Oh! Drink for the cat.
Yeah, drink for the cat. Now, I want to say this. This is why I don't call myself a feminist. I support women, but I am not a feminist. I am an equalist. I believe in equality all around, good and bad. You get what you deserve for good or for ill.
Also, let's not forget that there was that one person who married themselves and then accused themselves of cheating. I think that was from last year.
Yeah.
Wow. You know, Emma Stone, sweetie, like I said, I hope you enjoy your intimate relationship with your cats.
No. I'm going to say this. I predict that in a few years she will probably be the lead actress in the Hollywood adaptation of The Rise and Fall of Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
And she'll have to put on some bronzer and then to make herself feel Latina, and she'll end up being canceled.
Yep. God, that was one hell of a time to join back in. And sorry about that, guys. My cat is a cat. Fucking dick.
Also, cat. I should note a little bit of a small, minor update on the Jarvis story. Sid Alpha just put out a video, and he pretty much agreed. Just from the title alone, yeah, he agrees with us.
Yeah, link that vid in the console when you get the chance.
I'll do that right now.
But the next thing we have is China doing curfew and time limits, and there it is.
Here we go. Our China story for tonight. God damn it! Thought you could do business in China. Thought you'd be getting out of easy, right? Well, here's your reward, you idiot.
Apparently, no animal shocker. My cat is not a feminist. My cat's just a fucking dick.
Yeah. A perfect fit for you there, Doku.
Apparently.
You want me to throw him in the helicopter too?
So,
by the way, Aaron,
yeah,
perfect play for this for this MOOC. Yep. Send them to Detroit.
Oh, definitely.
No, no, not Detroit. No, no, please, anything but that.
So here's the thing. Now, apparently, this is curtail online addiction again.
Drink!
Now this is specifically aimed at minors, but the hours and the times are kind of odd. First off, between 10 p.m. and 8 a.m. Okay, no minor should be up that late anyways. Then the curfew, which will affect all online games being played in China. Under 18s will be restricted to 90 minutes of online gaming during the week, where they can and 3 hours per day on weekends and public holidays.
Jesus Christ, that is strict!
It's China, of course it is.
Yeah, fair point.
Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, this is what we call authoritarianism.
Yeah, really. And another thing, Mark Kern, was also pretty concerned about this, because now he's afraid that because of this, now the Chinese are going to try to go back into the U.S. and start investing in more gaming companies, which is very bad news.
Mm-hmm. Well, as a brief aside, and I don't want to derail too much, so I'll make this quick. The second you see someone wanting you to give up your freedoms, or tax you more money, or as a certain individual might say, I'm from the government and I'm here to help. This is why you should throw them off a fucking bridge as quickly as humanly possible, because they don't give a flying fuck about you. That's and if you want to know what the end result is, well, here you fucking go.
Toku, not throw them off the bridge. Sparta kick them off.
Oh, also, by the way, drink, because if we don't drink, then we're not going to be able to fuel up the helicopters quick enough.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. And also, kick them off 300 style. But instead of this is Sparta, this is America! Boom!
So, we haven't taken enough shots at dumbasses on campuses. Time to do that.
Yes. Here we go.
Good Lord in hell.
It's time to do so.
So, a student at Weber State University recorded his debate instructor suggesting that space travel is related to race, and that it can be argued that space is not real because it is one of many white fantasies. What the fuck?
What the fuck?
Are you on drugs?
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Are they pumping in some sort of hallucinogen over at Weber State?
Yes.
Mildred,
it's not even a question at this point. It's just
Mildred, I love you, homie. I love you, bro. Please repeat that. Please.
I'll repeat that. How about that? A student, an idiot at Weber State University recorded his debate instructor. Well, actually, he's not an idiot. He's a decent.
He's
guy.
The smart one. It's his instructor that's the idiot.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me do this one more time. An absolute mad lad at Weber State University recorded his debate instructor, an idiot, suggesting that space travel is related to race and that it can be argued that space is not real because it's one of many white fantasies.
Ace, I'm gonna need you to do your gimmick.
But wait! It gets better!
The instructor was also caught on video defending and complimenting a student presentation, suggesting that all white people should be sent to outer space.
Oh, for God's sakes. You know what, you dumbass instructor? You know what, just for saying that, I'd like to send you somewhere, but it ain't going to be outer space.
Send them to Detroit!
No! No, not Detroit! No! No, please! Anything with that!
Into the tree you go.
You know what? Because of the idiocy, the ignorance, the stupidity of this statement, because of just how off the wall absurd it is, because of how far down it's into the fucking identitarian fucking Alice in Wonderland, the Mad Hatter is fucking jacking off to his own fucking top hat, the fucking Queen of Hearts is a fucking transgender Zim rabbit hole that this fucking bullshit is. There needs to be something fucking special for this level of just, you're a fucking moron.
I think I got the perfect button for this.
Yes.
The foolishness of that comment is so deep, I can only ascribe it to higher education. Yep. You have to have gone to college to say something that stupid.
When the recording student questions the argument about sending white people to outer space, the instructor suggests that the presenting students do not have to answer his questions because he is white. I love how the people who claim to be against racism and claim to want true equality are the biggest racists imaginable.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
Oh, yeah.
This isn't a rise. This isn't a tape bowl. No, the equivalent of this, just in the few, maybe a minute and a half of what I've heard, this is the equivalent of, you went to the fucking Event Horizon, the ship went to hell, decided to give you a fucking sex change operation, and then you came back. That is the level of fucking stupidity.
And I saw that one coming.
Yeah.
I was surprised, really.
I'm so glad I recommended that for a button.
Oh, we've gotten so much use out of an ace, I swear to God.
That is my contribution to society. You are welcome.
We live in a society. Bottom text.
Yep.
So, moving on from that, this is a case of the use of words for other than their literal intention. Now that is irony.
Play stupid games, win stupid prizes.
Oh, come on.
Oh, boy.
Well, I hope you have that fucking rise button ready, because I have a feeling you're going to need it here in a bit.
I'm not rising just yet, I think. But
in a bit.
I think for the kids, I think for the kids, we probably just out of respect for the kids.
Ashley Ozane, who had been battling depression and anxiety in addition to arthritis and lupus.
Oof.
Good night, sweet meme.
Oh, yeah.
Had taken out her three children, Parrish 11, Eleanor 9, and Lincoln 7, by gunshots, and then the mother killed herself. She was a vocal advocate for stricter gun control in the United States, with multiple social media postings calling for an end to gun violence. And
you forgot one detail, dude.
What?
She had just finalized a contentious divorce from their father. Now this pisses me off.
And that's a rise.
Why the fuck did you divorce from him and take the kids and just and then kill all three of them? You are a fucking monster.
Yeah.
Saying she's a monster is being kind or very disrespectful to monsters. You're not even a demon.
This is, for those of you who have seen Firefly, this is the special hell. I initially grabbed this piece because it seemed a bit of twisted irony that somebody who was against gun violence ended up meeting their own end through that. But then it just got worse. So I'm going to move on from that. And instead I'm going to take some shots at Nintendo Soup and go Nintendo. Nintendo Soup tried to claim that a character for an upcoming Pokemon anime named Go is non-binary, which he is not.
You know what? I see a train a coming.
All aboard!
Oh my God!
Another train wreck.
And Switchpoint called them out, saying, "In the actual article, it said that he is androgynous, i.e., a pretty boy, and the fact that he's being voiced by an upcoming idol, which is not an uncommon thing."
But so this isn't really a non-binary thing here. It's just
this is a case where they ended up jumping on, and this is the reason why I've always argued to not make a big deal about what someone's orientation is unless it's relevant, much like someone's race, because then you have people resting on their laurels on the idea of our story is good after all, we have a non-binary character, and acting like that's a substitute for actually making a character. It's a case where you're trying to jump at straws, and
yeah, no shit.
Because of that, my take here is that they should have done proper diligence when covering the interview, but they didn't. Because they wanted to get the story out quick. Well, now because of that, you get laughed at. Congratulations.
Yeah, they won.
In fact.
Yeah, they won. You know what?
DJ yeah. Khaled.
Khaled.
Oh, yeah.
Congratulations. You played yourself.
So moving right along. This is the other tank bowl that we have, because not only do we have Batwoman, who's currently on a downward spiral, Supergirl Wolkman. Is also on a downward spiral, Supergirl. And Wolkman is on a downward spiral.
Yep, it's a television tank bowl!
Tank bowl!
Now, with Supergirl, some decline was going to be inevitable, although I remember seeing the first three episodes of Supergirl and not being all that impressed. With CW's Batwoman, the problem they have is that's not Batwoman.
Yeah, that's some freaking pink hair you just decided to put a Batman costume on.
Well, the whole thing is they stole the Batman costume and modded it.
Yeah.
But Batwoman's 18-49 demo.
If you look at,
as stated down. Oh, go ahead.
I was just gonna say, if you look at the more recent Batwoman comics, I get what they were going with, but bro, who the fuck is your costume designer? Because that shit looks tacky as fuck.
But yeah, they've had a 10% decline from episodes 4 and 5, which doesn't sound like much, but that's compiling with the declines we've seen for the last few weeks. Keep in mind, granted, they stated a decent amount regarding demos, but going from 1.28 to 1.6 after premiering at 1.8, ouch. Wow.
Yeah, that isn't good. Mm-hmm. Like,
that's WWE numbers, man.
Oh yeah.
And
real quick, with the level of promotion and how much the shill access media was trying to hype you guys up, I mean, me and Chandra watched the first like 2 episodes, and yeah, it was bad. But holy shit, dude, that type of drop off. Even the shill access media and the fucking woke crowd isn't defending your shit. Like, bro, you done fucked up. You done fucked up.
Oh, I got the button right here. Yep.
Hold on. Oh, now you fucked up. Now you fucked up. Now you fucked up. You have fucked up now. Now you fucked up. Now you fucked up. Now you fucked up! Now you fucked up!
Okay, since Hairball brought it up in the chat, I'm going to say this right now. Since he's picturing a monastery version of the 12 Days of Monkmas, if somebody is willing to write the full version of that, I will read it off and post it.
Yeah,
dude. Fuck that! I'll sing it!
Well, if it has to be read off or sing, I will do something with that, because that'll be great content. But yep. we have Supergirl season 5, which premiered at a 1.2. Its fifth episode is now at a 0.7. 783,000 total viewers. Ooh. Fucking ow!
Oh, oof. Wow!
Ouch!
That's.
Oh, Ace, man.
That's bad. Yeah.
I need that gimmick.
But wait! It gets better!
Black Lightning
is
also struggling. Their latest thing got a 0.17, which is down 14.24% from its previous episode.
Jesus Christ!
What episode are they on? Aren't they only on like episode 3 or 4?
Episode 4, season 3.
Yep.
Now, like, ladies and gentlemen, these are the numbers that
networks look at, and even networks like CW, because they realize that Marvel, like whatever, fucking DC is their cash cow. They're going to look at these numbers and go, yeah, put this shit online. We don't want this on the network anymore. Yeah. These are the numbers that kill shows.
Hey, Spade, you want to know what's even better? A couple weeks ago, the CW ordered more shows of Batwoman.
Yep.
They're going to be regretting that decision.
You know, the thing is, normally I would use this as the butt of a joke, but that doesn't even feel like punching down. That just feels like me being mean at this point.
The only show
so far that's shown that's been in the black regarding this has been The Flash.
Yeah,
I think what this is a consequence of is trying to do way too many shows way too quickly.
Oh yeah.
Like I get the feeling that they're looking towards Crisis on Infinite Earths to bring up the numbers, and if that doesn't work, some shows, if not all of them, might be getting the axe.
Now, I want to tackle this briefly, but do you remember when we talked about that one guy from the Des Moines Register? He decided to put up a thing in the Columbia Journalism Review trying to cry victim about how he was supposedly bullied off the internet for what he did in his article.
Oh, drink. This nitwit.
Immediate drink.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh boy.
Because he's whining about the fact that in the aftermath of what happened with the Carson King story, he got fired.
And it's, trying to
give his side of the story, and nobody's buying it.
Cry me a river.
Down here, salt is a way of life.
Obviously, the environment down here is all salt. The ceiling's salt, the floor is salt, the walls are salt, and to an extent, the air is salt. And you breathe that in, and you can constantly taste the salt.
No simpy, buddy.
Yeah, and then he goes, he was subject to a maelstrom of misunderstanding, anger, and hatred. There was no reason why you had to put up that old-ass tweet from when he was watching Tosh.0 in your article. There was no reason whatsoever that you put it in there. He ended up losing the deal that he had with Budweiser. And you're surprised that people want your head on a stick.
Now I'm annoyed. Now I'm annoyed. And you know what happens?
Put in John Moxley going, I want that dude's head on a stick.
I'm annoyed. You know what happens to people that annoy me? Those people go to Detroit!
Yep.
No! No, not Detroit! No! No, please! Anything with that!
And he goes on about death threats being frightening. And nobody deserves
death threats. Nobody mentioned really.
First off, nobody deserves death threats. We covered this last week with the guy behind Tardigrades getting threats from Discovery fanboys. But at the same time, again, it's hard for me to feel sympathy when you kick the hornet's nest. And then try and blame it on Mike Cernovich covering you and other people covering you. You fucked up. People are going to cover you because you fucked up.
Yep,
then he tries to say that there was never any attempt to cancel Carson King. Then why the fuck did you put that thing in there? You knew exactly what you were doing. Do not lie to me.
Freaking Christ. It's bad enough to try to do that shit. And now you're gonna try to walk that back? Are you really that dumb? You know what? I'm not just going to say no simpy. I'm just going to have Scott Steiner talk to you about this shit. Here you go.
And here's the thing, Mildred. I'm going to give you...
of the people, but you don't get my simpy at all.
<Damn it! laughs>
But here's the thing, Mildred. I'm going to give you a little bit of pushback. I don't give a flying fuck about death threats from people on the fucking internet. And you want to know why? Because I don't give a flying fuck about red flag laws. They're bullshit. And if you want to try to restrict my Second Amendment rights, go ahead and try. But you know what?
Lobby.
Good luck. You can try. Let's see what the fuck happens.
You think Doku's security?
Good luck. Look,
you think Doku's scary with a sword? Yeah.
Look, just telling you, I know how to.
Go ahead.
I know how to break down a 1911. I know how to break down an M4, not an AR-15. Like you dumbasses don't know the difference between the two of them.
Of course they.
I know how to break down a fucking Mossberg. You think I care about you fucking little pussy ass bitches? Try to fucking come into my house. See what the fuck happens.
But I
don't give a flying fuck about your death threats.
I wouldn't be surprised if this whole instance with the Des Moines Register ends up making it significantly harder for him to get a job. But hey, maybe he can get a job at BuzzFeed. They certainly seem to like journalists of his caliber.
Or better yet, we should start practice coding.
Learn to count, asshole!
Yep.
That was good. That was funny. I'm gonna drink to that just because, damn.
Cheers!
But cheers! Now we cheers. For the next thing...
Cheers to Mildred.
Could...
Oh! A little bit of the bubbly!
Could one of you please hit the Voss button? Because I think it's a called for here.
I agree. Button?
Voss.
Oh, yeah, here we go.
Did I ever tell you what the definition of insanity is? Insanity is doing the exact same fucking thing over and over again, expecting shit to change. That is crazy.
You know, Marvel. Maybe you should hire Pablo Romero to do Captain Marvel.
He wouldn't last. He'd only be able to do one issue before he got ran out of town. But more importantly, Captain Marvel's comic book sales have dropped to the point of near reboot again.
You know what? No. I'm not calling near reboot status. Marvel, take the L. Kill it. Kill the character. Kill the books. You're not saving her anymore. How many times? Six reboots in 3 years? You can't salvage this anymore. The movie killed it.
This has been dead since Kelly Sue DeConnick took over.
Yeah, you know what? They won't do that. You want to know why?
Why? Because fuck them, that's why.
Well, you know what I say to that? Fuck them. Fuck them. Fuck you!
Yep.
Fuck you, Marvel. Kill the goddamn books!
Yeah, it's like now, a damn franchise zombie
real
at this
quick,
point.
Real quick. As a comic book fan who has talked to people from multiple political ideological walks of life, hey, Marvel... You want to make that book? You want to resurrect that character? Make it at least attractive or appealable to the people you're trying to market it to, because even the blue hairs and the shaved heads don't like it because your writers suck. Or maybe just bring back Miss Marvel. You want to know why people liked Harley Quinn the way that she was? Kind of the same reason that gamers like characters like Kasumi. Because they, despite being, you know, feminine, something for whatever reason you don't like, they still use their femininity as a weapon.
Yeah,
or
like
maybe
said,
more on point. Now, I want to set the stage for a little bit.
Like
so
I said,
the sales numbers for last month have... The sales numbers for September et al. Have come about. Captain Marvel number 10 only 27,400 issues sold to local shops. Now, keep in mind, that's the ship numbers. That's not the actual sales numbers. The previous issue
the diamond. The diamond numbers.
Yeah. These are the diamond numbers.
Yeah.
So these are the numbers that are getting shipped. Previous issue, 37,800. So that's a drop of 27% at the very least. And the sole reason that people were possibly buying Captain Marvel number 9 was because it having the first appearance of Star and nothing to do with the actual character of the book. And they didn't buy another issue. Even trying to turn Carol Danvers into a villain hasn't done anything because that was a case of, oh, what took you so long? And
I mean, that's not.
I have to bring this up once again. Kevin Feige tried to say that Captain Marvel was Marvel's best-selling character.
Bullshit.
Really, Feige? You idiot!
MJF!
Oh, shit! Oh, my God, you're such a loser, dude.
Good God.
You know what? Here's the scary thing. If that's your best-selling character, then you're telling me that all of your other characters are selling so poorly that Captain Marvel is the best thing you have to offer. Okay. If that's the hill you want to die on.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, no, Captain Marvel is the best you got. Go ahead and just die.
So here's the thing. This is actually, and call it what you will, because I know you guys are going to love this. This is actually an absolute selling ploy. Because, hear me out, by saying that this is their best-selling item, people are going to obviously not believe it. So how are they going to find out? They're either going to do one of two things. They're either going to read about it online, or they're going to go buy it and try and find out, which, you know, feeds into the whole, it's our best-selling thing. That is the only reason Faye would even attempt to say this. Because, as you guys are noticing right now, making this statement is basically ritual suicide.
Yeah, but Hail Mary.
And I don't disagree with you, and what this tells me is, yeah, the show media did its job, the movie got some numbers. What it's telling me is they're hoping, praying to whatever gods there are, that if we say Captain Marvel is our best-selling comic book, please go buy the comic book, that's telling me the comic book isn't selling.
Oh, no, guaranteed. Absolutely guaranteed.
And
because let's also remember, just to backpedal a little bit, have they featured Captain Marvel in anything since the movies, in media-wise? No.
Nope.
You know who's gotten featured predominantly?
Black Widow.
Marvel. Well, Black Widow as well. Miss Marvel, Kamala Khan. That is who is trying to be associated with the Marvel brand right now.
And or at least you know in the main public eye. They're doing a better job with Kamala Khan than they are with Captain Marvel.
Yep.
Actually, I have to give them that, and I've talked trash about Kamala Khan and America Chavez and Riri Williams. But they are doing a better job with those three characters than they are with Carol Danvers.
Not by much, though.
When Ironheart relaunched, it actually got better. It's got some problems, including a too much text problem, but it's not offensively bad.
I will actually agree with you. I did look a little bit about some of the when they relaunched her as Ironheart, like changed up the whole suit backstory and everything. It's not the best thing in the world, but it's about on the same quality as the Jane Foster's Thor relaunch back from a few years ago.
Just
it's
without ethics and hammer wielding. But anyway,
yeah.
William Shatner once again continues to have no chill.
Oh boy! Oh, William fucking Shatner!
Of course, it's Shatner, the absolute mad lad.
since he took to Twitter to explain what woke means, saying, quote, "Those children who grew up in that kinder, gentler world use presentism to remove books, have decided that any historical figure who has done things that, by today's society, are intolerable should be struck from history. How is the next gen going to learn from past mistakes?"
Mm-hmm.
I cannot argue with this man!
On point! On point!
And then somebody called the inner child, wow, that's tempting fate, who accused him of being obtuse, said, "I'm not being obtuse at all when I say I find it utterly ridiculous that supposed learnedly people use presentism to erase the past because they want to pretend that the past views are not PC by today's standards were wrong. What happens when today's views are tomorrow's follies?"
Ooh, yeah, we see.
Oh,
on
cheers.
Point on this
that's
one.
A verbal bitch slap.
And yeah, he ain't
that's cheers also to cheers. That shit.
He ain't done.
Oh, a little bit of the bubbly.
Thanks. The original tweet was a threat that millennials could erase my past work. Her name is Laura Ingalls Wilder, and the Wilder Award, which was renamed because presentists complained that her books contained disparaging remarks of the 1870s towards indigenous people.
Oh my god.
The library did it in response to complaints. Do you really think that in 2018, baby boomers or Gen X suddenly realized these books were bad? No, it got adopted and reworked to be the joke it is today. To be woke is to be uninformed, which is exactly the opposite of what it stands for.
Exactly.
Oh.
He hit it right on the freaking the nose. Shades, I think that deserves a what you call it?
And dude, please repeat that, because holy shit, yes, you're correct.
He said to be woke is to be uninformed, which is exactly the opposite of what it stands for.
Yes.
This is William Shatner, right?
Yep.
Yes. Yep.
Okay. We've covered stuff like this before.
Yep, this is not the first time we've covered Shatner.
And we've mentioned before, and I've said this on this show before, that you do not fuck with William Shatner. Am I right?
Yes.
And fuck, you know what? You know what? I'm going to retweet that in a minute and basically throw up Alexander's razor. I know you've never heard of it. That's mine. And what Alexander's razor is you show me someone who's extraordinarily woke, I'll show you someone who's extraordinarily bigoted.
I think we already cut that razor about an hour ago.
Yep. Serious. Again, you know, it's when I covered the whole cancel culture thing a couple of weeks ago, one of the things that even President Obama said is basically on these same lines. And again, say what you will about Obama, whether you love him or hate him, we're not here to talk about that. True. But even he gets this shit.
Although I do love that shortly after that they